John. That's cool. Thanks.
Hello, welcome to Gnomon, everyone. Thanks for joining us this evening. So this is pretty awesome. We have Alex Alvarez here on the stage with us tonight. As many of you will know, Alex is the founder, president, and visionary of the Gnomon School here in Los Angeles, as well as the fantastic Gnomon Workshop online training platform. Without both of those things, we wouldn't have these incredible opportunities to host these and stream these free events for the community. So I think we should have a big round of applause for that first. So as well as dedicating the past 18 years to educating both students and professional artists around the world, literally changing the face of computer graphics education, Alex has also been working professionally in the industry on some amazing projects with the likes of James Cameron, J.J. Abrams, including Avatar, Star Trek, Super 8, Green Lantern, and Prometheus, too. So Alex is invited to talk at events and conferences literally all around the world. So we are super, super excited to have him here at the home of Gnomon tonight to have an exclusive talk for us. So before I hand over to Alex, there's just a couple things to mention. I know he has a two-hour talk packed for you. So just a few things. We'll open up the floor to audience questions around 9 p.m., I think. So if you have questions, you'll have opportunities to ask those later. And obviously, if Alex asks you at some point to pitch questions, feel free to do so. Just make sure you wait for the mic to come to you so that Alex can hear your questions. For those watching online, welcome. Thank you for joining us as well. You can also ask questions at any time on Twitter. Just use hashtag Gnomon. That's G-N-O-M-O-N. And we'll look out for those. We'll try to read out as many online questions as possible later this evening with time permitting. So please chat to us and we'll do our best to keep up. So without further ado, let's have a big round of applause for Alex. Thank you. All right.
Thank you. All right. Hi. Thank you for coming, and thanks, Lynette, and everybody who's helped put this together. This is something that is a presentation I actually put together and gave in Melbourne, but it wasn't streamed, so if anybody, you know, on the live stream watched the Melbourne one, then you saw this already. But the difference is there I had an hour, and I was talking way too fast, and so for you guys, I got two, so I'll be able to slow it down a little bit. And so in regards to natural environment stuff, for, you know, since I was a kid, I was always pretty much interested in character and creature stuff. As far as doing environments, it's something that back in the 90s when I got into 3D, I tried playing with some tools like Onyx Tree Pro, which was around in the 90s, but a tree would be 100,000 polys or 200,000 polys, and even loading that up on a $50,000 SGI machine would pretty much kill it. And so I just figured it wasn't like the time yet. And about 4 years ago, just started messing around just to see how things had progressed, and was just shocked at how Mental Ray, and now I use V-Ray, you know, were able to handle and push polygons. And I started getting sort of obsessive about doing natural environments. So for the last 4 years, that's kind of been my focus. And for this evening's talk, something that about almost a year ago I got into was trying to use photogrammetry to build assets. Because a big part of doing environment work, at least for me, has been to build libraries. So building libraries of trees and plants and bushes and so forth. But for those types of things, you have really good procedural solutions. So tools like SpeedTree and Onyx are great for making procedural plants and so forth. But when it comes to things like specific assets like a rock or a log or a tree, those are things that there aren't great procedural tools for. And modeling those kinds of things is really hard. You know, so anybody in here who's tried to sculpt a rock in ZBrush knows that you immediately think it's going to be easy, and then you realize that it actually is a very, very challenging thing to pull off. Because things like trees and rocks and logs have their own anatomy to them and language that you need to be able to learn about and study. So with photogrammetry, this is something that I followed for a long time too, because it's been around since I think like 98 or 99 is when Paul Debevec started doing, you know, his research with photogrammetry, and The Matrix was the first movie that used it. But back then it was proprietary tools, and then Image Modeler came out from RealViz, which allowed you to use photos to model geometry, but it didn't really model the geometry for you. It created locators in 3D space, and you still kind of had to model. So I kind of like didn't really pay attention to it for a while, and then about a year ago, saw some stuff that was going on with game studios that were using Photoscan, and decided to start playing with it. And Agisoft, which is a software company, Photoscan, is really cool and a straightforward, easy program to use once you know certain rules about how to shoot the photos. And that's the kind of stuff we'll be talking about tonight. And I'll try and be as specific with you as possible in regards to how to shoot your photos and how to prep them, how to process them in Photoscan, how to bring them into ZBrush, how to clean them up, how to go into Maya, just so that you can end up with a usable production asset. Because the geometry you get out of Photoscan can be really heavy. So some of the landscape stuff that I've done, this is all personal stuff, so just showing some different images, using a variety of tools. So Maya is my main program that I use, and so everything kind of revolves around Maya for me. And so whether it's SpeedTree or ZBrush or World Machine or whatever, that's kind of everything ends up in Maya and gets rendered in V-Ray. So this is something that's, you know, a fully, you know, 3D landscape. This is primarily World Machine. It's something that is a tool that I started using also about a year and a half ago. World Machine is amazingly cool. This is another World Machine landscape rendered in Maya with some bushes that I probably made in SpeedTree or PaintFX. This is a landscape that I did about a year and a half ago, and so this was for a DVD that I did just on using satellite data. And satellite data is kind of low res, and so you kind of have to up res it and then populate it. So I've got tons of trees and sides here and bushes, but again, something that was missing in my library really was rocks and boulders and that kind of stuff, which again is kind of why photogrammetry seemed really appealing. And this is a very heavy scene. This scene is like 15 billion polygons, which you wouldn't think, but that's the cool thing of using proxies, is that each tree in there, like those tiny little trees, are hero trees. So they're like 200,000 to 400,000 polygons per tree. So I could fly the camera all the way through the scene down into a tree through the leaves, which is kind of nuts. But that's the cool thing about using proxies when you're using renderers like V-Ray and Mental Ray. World Machine experiment, textured in Maya and rendered in V-Ray. Same kind of thing. And then this is where I started playing with scan stuff, where I took a trip, and we'll be talking about that later, out to a place that's not far from here called Ladder Canyon and Painted Canyon, Death Valley, and wanted to create something along those lines, and found a website that's pretty cool called Surface Mimic. Some of you may have heard of it, where you can download some scan-based or photogrammetry-based assets and displacement maps and color maps, and they're really, really cool to use in ZBrush. And so I downloaded a couple of these rock photogrammetry generated grayscale displacement maps and started making alphas for ZBrush to sculpt with out of them, and made a very simple environment in Maya that I blocked out real quick, brought that into ZBrush, started using those alphas, and since these alphas were generated from scans, the quality of what I got was really, really, really cool. And so that immediately made me feel like I need to learn how to make these myself. And so that's where I wanted to figure out if Photoscan was something that I could use. So this is a very quick process making this. This making the entire image from start to finish was probably, I'd say, about 2 or 3 hours. And so about 10 minutes in Maya, then about 45 minutes in ZBrush with alphas, because I'm not sculpting, I'm using alphas with drag rectangle, which goes really fast, and then texturing it in Maya with just a library of rock shaders that I have. So that's the whole thing with building libraries, that if you have a library of alphas, a library of rocks, trees, plants, whatever, these things can go fast. So when I say, like, I built this in 3 hours, it's like, but I already had that tree model in my library, and I already had these bushes in my library, and I already had these little rocks to place around in the ground. And so just some more landscape experiments. These were the displacements coming from satellite data. This is another World Machine experiment. I've built a library of alphas from World Machine and displacement maps so that I can create terrain elements, mesas, canyons, and then have planes in Maya that I can apply these displacement maps to and rotate them and move them around and do scene layout really, really quickly. And then this image is what we're going to be mostly talking about this evening in regard as like an example, just so I sort of needed to have something that I could break apart to discuss how the image was made. And there are photogrammetry-based assets inside this image. And so this is also inspired by this road trip that I did out to the desert. And so let's move on to that. So the first thing that I'm going to talk about here is the fact that with photogrammetry, you have to go outside, right? And so, but it's an often awesome excuse to do that. And the nice thing about Southern California is that within 5 hours of here, of LA, you've got everything. And so I don't know how many of you, you know, have taken road trips, but Death Valley is only 5 hours from here. And so 5 hours northeast. And so we're getting to the time of year that you don't want to go. It's in August, it's the hottest place on earth, so it can get to be like 135 degrees there, which is crazy. When I went, it was like in the 70s. Right now, it's probably in the 80s. And the first time I went to Death Valley, I actually went to Death Valley, shot photos all day, and came back the same day. So, but you have to like to drive, and I love driving. So like, I really don't mind getting in my car and going places. And so Death Valley is something that has been used in tons of films and movies. And so I just Googled Death Valley Star Wars, like I knew it was a location for that. And immediately a website popped up that has like all the locations in Death Valley where they shot certain scenes. And you can see like these are people dressed up as a Yoda, finding these locations and so forth. So it's really, really beautiful and super, super cool. And so here I'm just going to show you where it is. I just did a Camtasia recording from Google Earth. And so there we are in LA. And then 5 hours northeast, there's Death Valley National Park. And it's really, really large. And so zooming in here, there's a really, really cool little canyon called Titus Canyon that you can drive your car down. And so that's it right there. So when you get into Death Valley, you have to actually drive through Death Valley on a highway into Nevada. And then you enter this canyon right there, and you drive your car all the way down and exit there. And so, and I'm showing you this kind of stuff because really, if you want to collect awesome assets for photogrammetry, you have to go to places where these things are. So some of you may have seen like the kite demo, the Unreal kite demo, where they also talked about some photogrammetry stuff, and they're like, and we went to Scotland and New Zealand. And it's like, well, that's rad, but that's far. So I'd love to be able to go to Iceland or Scotland and do a photogrammetry excursion. But with the Sequoia National Park, Death Valley, the desert, you really can find places that are absolutely stunningly beautiful within a drive. And then you just walk through these places, drive through these places, and you just see a cool rock, and you're like, I want that rock, I want that tree, I want that cliff, and you just start taking photos of it, knowing when you get back home, you're going to have that as an asset. So this is the drive approaching Titus Canyon from the Nevada side. And so this trip to Death Valley for me was actually a photography trip. It wasn't actually a photogrammetry trip. And so I wanted to just spend a couple days doing HDR photography and sort of processing it through Lightroom and Photomatics and trying to just get, try to practice photography, because I've learned in wanting to do landscapes that the best thing I can do is really study what my tastes are in regards to composition and try and get better at that, and how I want to color grade my photos to have them give them a certain look, and just experiment with that whole process. And if you do it via photography, you just get to try so many different things so much faster than you will with your 3D work. And so you just get a lot of inspiration kind of baked into your mind. So once I approach Titus Canyon, this is what it starts to look like. And it is this really, really cool canyon. You can see this is basically the width of a car. And with the warm colored rocks and the cool lighting from the sky above, it's just really, really beautiful. And you get beautiful inspiration for ideas and what you might want to do and utilize in the environments that you're creating. And so this is just, again, all of these are processed in Lightroom. But that's something that ultimately I think a lot of us are doing with our 3D work too, whether it's color grading in DI that you're doing in Nuke or you're doing in another tool. This is something that is a good thing to also try and experiment, and that's what I was trying to do with this project. And so as we drive through, just a lot of great examples of lighting and bounce light. Here we're now exiting Titus Canyon, and then when you get out of Titus Canyon, then you see the valley of Death Valley. And it's massive. It's really, really huge. So has anybody in here been to Death Valley? So a few of you. I really, really recommend just getting some friends together and drive out before August. So because of that trip to Death Valley, I definitely was like, I want to be able to make environments that look like that specifically. So I'm going to try and build a library of assets that I'm going to try and get into photogrammetry. And ideally, that's going to give me a faster approach to build these kinds of things. Because if you were going to try to make something like this, where you're just going to sculpt a base mesh in Maya or ZBrush and Dynamesh it and start sculpting with like damn standard and the standard brush, and I mean, it will take you a while, right? Because it is really, there's so much chaotic detail in nature. And so that's where you need to find a faster approach. So yes, you can hand sculpt it, but do you have a week to do that? And so the faster you can approach things while still maintaining art direction and artistic control, the more fun you will have. So for creating the image that I showed you earlier, these ultimately become the steps. So I need to create a library of elements with photogrammetry. I need to lay out scenes and my composition in Maya. I then detail these things using World Machine and ZBrush, and then obviously materials, lighting, and rendering, compositing. I'm still doing most of my compositing in Photoshop. I know I should switch to Nuke. I'm very aware of that. But I'm just still very used to doing it in Photoshop. And I'm working on stills for personal work primarily. And then color grading. There's an awesome plugin for After Effects called Magic Bullet that I really, really like a lot, which is a color grading plugin. So we're going to go through all of these steps that are right there. So starting with photogrammetry. So photogrammetry is creating 3D models from 2D photographs. And so for this image, as an example, this is what the geometry looks like. And this is what, for this image, is Photoscan or photogrammetry based. So it's not the entire image. It's just, in the end, some assets that are useful, a tree trunk, a tree, things that ultimately are hero assets in the sense that if you looked at them up close, they're incredibly detailed and awesome because they come from photogrammetry. But because I made them so quickly through that process, I don't mind using them just for set dressing and putting this log over here and this rock over here and this boulder. So for these assets, I needed to first go through the process of finding a place that I wasn't as far as Death Valley to start collecting rocks and logs and whatever. So what I'm showing you here now is sort of this trip that I took, another road trip, to start shooting photos of things for the purposes of photogrammetry. So has anybody been here? Nobody's been here. All right. Ladder Canyon is only 2.5 hours away. So if you know where Palm Springs is like 2 hours east. So you like just get on the 10 and go that way. And then when you get to Palm Springs, you just keep going south from there, and there's the Salton Sea. Which is actually pretty massive and a pretty cool place to check out. And it's really, really close to the Salton Sea. So it's not a national park, but it's this canyon, which is like this 5-mile loop that you can hike. And it's called Ladder Canyon because somebody, I don't know who, because this isn't a national park, so this isn't like the, you know, state putting this stuff there, but there's like these metal ladders everywhere, and you can see that's a big one. And so you're just trusting that these ladders work. And a lot of them are pretty tattered and broken, but it's really, really cool. And so here I'm going to show you where Ladder Canyon is. And so we're zooming in. You can see there's the Salton Sea right there. And so there's Palm Springs right up there. And so from Palm Springs, it's just another maybe 20 or 30 minutes. And then this right here is where you park your car. And when I went there, there was probably like 4 cars or something like that. I didn't see a soul for the 5 hours. Because it's this, basically, you hike in there, and it's this whole loop that you go around that has slot canyons. So places like Arizona and Utah are more known for slot canyons, like Antelope Valley. But this is actually like a very local 2-hour drive to a slot canyon, which is really, really pretty. So here's some photos of that area. So this is me sort of approaching Ladder Canyon. This is where you park your car. And in the end, it's like you look at these forms and these shapes, and these are so, so cool. And it's like it's one thing to do a Google image search for like cool landscape, cool rocks, cool cliff, and we all find the same stuff. But really just going to these places is a million times more inspiring if you have the time, you know, and it really isn't that far. So then you start hiking. and then you end up inside the canyon. And so as opposed to Titus Canyon, where it's wide enough for a car, in Ladder Canyon, Payton Canyon, at some point it's only like a foot wide, 2 feet wide, so you're kind of scooting through this little canyon. And it's really, really, really cool. All sorts of different rock types, because Ladder Canyon loops around into what's called Painted Canyon, because there's so many different types of minerals and rocks there that it's just very, very colorful. That's my little R2-D2. that's actually my R2-D2 that I've had since I was a kid. So I've had that since 1978. So it's like this tattered little R2-D2. And I just thought it'd be cool to play some in some of the photos. Because the thing that's cool about that, and that has become very, very apparent, is that when you have assets, especially of things like rocks, cliffs, and boulders, scale from micro to macro with natural stuff is not readily apparent. So meaning that, is this area 5 feet across, or is this area 100 feet across, right? With that guy there, it looks like it's a much larger space than it is. And so I bring that up just meaning that you can create an asset from a boulder or a rock, but ultimately, once you get it in your scene, whether it's Maya, Unreal, or whatever, you could use this as a massive object or a tiny object, and it still kind of looks correct. And so same thing here. See, there he is. So it looks like this like epic kind of sci-fi vista, but it's really just this sort of relatively small area where if I was standing here, I'd be like, you know, pretty large. And so it's another cool way to come up with interesting compositions, because then with your camera, you're just looking around for interesting angles, interesting ways to try and perceive this environment that you could use for your own work. So like this is only like this big of an area, but you could see that this could easily work as being 500 yards wide with this village inside here with a castle that's over here. It's like, you know, it could work for that perfectly fine. And so if you think of it that way, these assets become really useful. So moving on to the photography, what I'm showing here is just basically one of my folders. You can see like photogrammetry, cliffs, and then like all these different photo sets that I had after this trip for Ladder Canyon, where I saw something that I thought was kind of cool, like the wall of a cliff, and figured, all right, I'm going to take photos of that. And so you end up walking around an object, and I'm going to give you a lot of detail in regards to that process. And so here is another thing. This is very large, so this is probably at least like 50 feet tall. And so the smaller the object, the easier it is to take photos, because if it's small, like I'm taking photos of this, then it's just like click, 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 I got my photos. When you have something that's 50 feet tall, then you're like click, walk 15 feet that way, click, and it just takes a while longer to walk around the object, but it still works. Here was just a cool bundle of rocks on the ground, which I felt could be a cool asset to have. And so for this, I'm shooting just a rock that I found. I brought a tripod with me so that I could get the top and the bottom of things. With things like a cliff face, you're talking about a flat object, so you're not going all the way around in a circle 360 degrees with that object. While with a rock, you're going to end up wanting to. And here's another example of a piece of wood that I found on that trip. So, like, this piece of wood is crazy. Like, it's really, really complicated. It would be a very, very complex thing to model. If you were going to model that thing by hand in ZBrush, this is a hero asset that you're going to go and do. But with photogrammetry, you can have assets that are this cool just as secondary assets that are part of a library that you can populate and set dress. So here's some renders from V-Ray of some of these things after they went through Photoscan, got cleaned up in ZBrush, got retopologized, UVs, textured, projected from the photos, and then in Maya rendered as an asset. So some really cool cliff faces. That look pretty neat. Some rocks. And so, you know, is this rock this big, or is this rock a massive boulder? Like, in reality, I know it was about this big, but not really, really clear or evident. And then here's that really, really cool piece of wood, which is about that big, fairly small. I tried doing a skull. This is a ram skull that I had at home. I was just curious if Photoscan could pull this off, and I was insanely impressed. I mean, I have a 4 or 5 million poly model of this, you know, from Photoscan. It's just like having that in ZBrush and just spinning around this ram skull I was just like, dude, this is the coolest thing in the world. I mean, it's like if you tried to sculpt this ram skull the way it is from reality, it would take so much skill, time, and talent. Not to say that's not a worthwhile pursuit, but ultimately, photogrammetry exists for those things that exist in the real world. You know, some people are like, well, is photogrammetry going to mean that we don't need modelers anymore? It's like, of course not. But for things like this, or a tree trunk, or a rock, well, those things you can get and you can find outside. But things that are designed and made up, we'll always need modelers for that. So now we're getting into some more specific details here. When I was researching photogrammetry and Photoscan and how to use it, for some reason, I couldn't really find a lot of information. The manual's not great, which is pretty typical with software. And I couldn't really find much on YouTube or Google searching in regards to step-by-step and specific rules. And so what you have here is basically based on me spending hundreds of hours going through the process, this is what I found works for me. So I'm not saying that I'm the authority, and if somebody knows more, I'd love to learn. You know, so you're more than welcome to talk to me later and tell me things that I was totally wrong about. But what I'm showing you does work, and I've done it over and over and over and over and over and over again on dozens of assets, and it's pretty solid. So first thing is you need a decent camera. So I'm using a Canon 5D Mark II, so which is probably 4 years old. So having a newer camera that's higher megapixel would be awesome. You'll get a much heavier model with a much higher res texture, but ultimately my 5D Mark II worked great. So you do not want to use your iPhone. So yes, you can download an app where you can go and take pictures of something and upload to the cloud, and it gives you a model. Like, you know, you've probably all seen these photogrammetry apps, and they're cool, but what you're getting is really, really low res. And so what I wanted was really, really high resolution assets where any of the assets I was creating could be a hero asset right up in camera and 4K renders. So then the lenses I'm using are prime fixed lenses. And so as you probably know, there are zoom lenses, right, where you can zoom in and zoom out and your lens goes from a 24 to a 105 or something like that. You can use a zoom lens for photogrammetry, but the thing is the software will do a better job as if all of your pictures are shot with the same focal length. Right, so all of the pictures are shot 35 or they're all 50 or so forth. And with the zoom lens, you have the danger of walking around an object and accidentally touching the zoom dial, and now they're not necessarily all the same. So I just think it's safer to use a fixed prime lens, although newer zoom lenses, some of them have locks on them, so you can lock the focal length and you won't accidentally mess it up. Manual mode is very important. This is where iPhones and cell phones become problematic in regards to how they shoot pictures. Every photo needs to be shot with the same exposure. And so the f-stop, the shutter speed, the ISO, and so forth are all things that you need to take into serious consideration. I'm going to have a slide here that's going to get into that in more detail. I shoot in RAW. And so that's because you have a much more light information in RAW. You don't have the JPEG compression artifacts because you're going to end up getting textures as well. Remember, with photogrammetry, you get a model that is textured, right? And so the photographs not only create the model, they get projected by the software to create the full 3D texture for your object. And by shooting in RAW, since it has plus or minus two stops of light information, it makes it easier for delighting the texture. 10 degrees between each photo with a fixed point of interest, 1 to 3 rows depending on the object, 36 photos per row tells you how many pictures you're potentially going to end up with, or 18 photos for a 180-degree object. So meaning picture, 10 degrees, picture, 10 degrees, picture, 10 degrees, picture. That's what seems to be working perfectly fine for all the assets that I've been doing. So to get into more detail about those bullet points, again, Canon 5D Mark II, which shoots basically a 5 to 6K image, right? So here we have the pixel resolution of the photos that I shoot on the camera. Now, Canon has a new camera that came out in the last year, the 5DS, which I would love to have, but I don't have. And it shoots almost 9K photos. Those are really, really, really high res. Just Google the 5DS example and look at some of like the raw photos out of that thing, they're huge. Well, is there a benefit to having that versus the camera I have? Yes, because the higher the megapixel the photos are, the higher res the model will be, and the higher res the textures will be. So with my 5D Mark II, the models that I'm getting are between 2 and 10 million polygons, depending on how much of the photograph the object fits, right? So if I'm shooting a photograph of a cliff face, the cliff face probably fills the whole frame, and I'm probably going to get a 10 million poly model. But if I'm shooting a skinny log, that might only fill 15% of screen space, so it might only be 1 or 2 million polys. So if I had the 5DS, I would just be getting much, much higher res stuff. And the textures I'm getting with my 5D Mark II are about 4K usable textures. With the 5DS, you'd probably be able to get 8K. The only issue would be that Photoscan, you'll see when we get to it, isn't the fastest thing in the world when it has to process. You do have to wait for the software to do its thing. And so I can imagine with a 5DS it'd be even slower, but I haven't tried that yet. So higher the resolution, higher res model and texture. There you go. There you go. So in regards to prime lenses, so these are the lenses that I am using. Prime lenses also are known for having superior optics. And so as opposed to a zoom lens that has multiple pieces of glass in it, a prime lens is going to have fewer elements. You get a sharper image generally. And so the nice thing about having good lenses is just the fact that you want, when you zoom into your image at 100%, whether it's in Photoshop or Lightroom, the whole thing to be in focus, be sharp, you know, be consistent from the center to the corner of the image. So sometimes cheap lenses look fine and look cool, but sometimes like the image gets a little darker as it goes to the corner, or you get chromatic aberration, which everybody's adding to their images these days, but you ideally don't want in the renders you're going to be using for photogrammetry. So more expensive lenses tend to not have that. So these lenses are Canon's L series lenses, and so they are a little bit pricier. But if you're a studio, then it's definitely a worthwhile investment to have this kit available for your crew that wants to do photogrammetry. Cheaper lenses will work just fine. It's just you'll have fewer headaches if you sort of follow some of these guidelines. So in regards to manual mode when you're shooting your photos, this is really, really important. And so I'm sure that a lot of you in here have probably used manual, traditional, point-and-shoot digital SLR cameras, and some of you maybe haven't. So if any of you are used to really where your like cell phone was like your first real camera, then you have some stuff to learn to get comfortable with in regards to using a real camera. But it's all things you want to know about anyway, especially if you're going to become an artist in our industry, because artists in our industry, whether you're lighters or art directors or concept artists or 3D artists, whatever, knowing about ISO and f-stop and shutter speed are all things that are very valuable things to know to understand how cameras work. But in regards to photogrammetry, you really want all of the images to have the same exposure settings. That, in a big way, has to do with the textures, right? Because as you go around the object, if all of your photos are shot with the same exposure settings, then as it projects the photos onto your model to give you the texture, then it's going to look correct because they're all lit in the exact same way. Then your f-stop. Your f-stop, I found 11 plus is really what you need. So in a camera, you have the hole that lets the light in, right? Your aperture. And your f-stop is what controls the size of that. So a small f-stop, like an f1.4, the opening gets a lot larger. And a high f-stop, like f11, the opening's getting a lot smaller, right? The smaller the opening is, or the higher the f-stop, so it's counterintuitive, but the smaller the opening is, the less light that's coming in, but conversely, what's also happening is the shallower your depth, or the larger your depth of field is getting. And so meaning that you've seen a photo where it's a portrait of somebody and the background's all blurred out, as opposed to a photo of somebody where the background's still in focus. What's controlling that depth of field is your f-stop. And so with photogrammetry, you want everything in focus. You ideally want the entire image completely in focus. The front of the rock's in focus, the back of the rock's in focus, so that Photoscan can properly grab onto that thing and build the model and project the textures. So shallow depths of field, where lots of the image is going out of focus, will become very problematic. And so f-stop of 11 plus on my 5D Mark II really has become a rule that I have to follow. Then in regards to the ISO, 800 or less, because the ISO is the sensitivity of your film or of your CCD on your camera, how sensitive it is to light. But if you put your ISO too high, 1600, 3200, 6400, you start to get noise. And you don't really want noise because you're going to be projecting these images onto your model to create the textures, and you don't want them to be noisy. So with my camera, ISO 800, the noise isn't really noticeable, and so I feel like I can go that high. And then your shutter speed. This depends on how steady you are at holding a camera. And so if you were as steady as a tripod, this would be irrelevant. But the reality is no matter how still you try and hold the camera, you're moving a little bit. You're breathing, it's windy, and whatever. And so do I use a tripod or not? Well, if you're out in Ladder Canyon and there's boulders and there's rocks everywhere, using a tripod would really slow you down big time, right? Because then you have to set the tripod up for every photo that you're taking. So it's so much more convenient to just like take a picture, walk two steps to the right, take a picture, so that you can take all of the pictures you need in like a minute by just walking around the object and snapping. But if you're hand holding a picture, then you have the danger of motion blur, right? Because if you move that camera while you take the picture, it's going to get a little blurry. So how do you compensate with that? Well, like breathe and think every time you take the picture that you're trying to have a steady hand, but also have a fast shutter speed. The faster your shutter speed, the less motion blur you get. So I know that what I'm saying in regards to this slide, anybody in here who's really experienced with cameras is going to seem very rudimentary, but it's very important to get good results out of Photoscan, so I just kind of feel like I need to illustrate that. So the thing is that when you have rules, right? F-stop has to be above 11, ISO needs to be below 800, shutter speed needs to be 1/25th of a second or faster, all of a sudden it becomes this balancing act. Because if you set them all to that number and take a picture, it might be completely underexposed or under or overexposed. And so you have to adjust those three things with these parameters to get a properly exposed image. So this is a great diagram. It was going around Facebook a while ago, and I thought it was a great diagram to show people. That explains your f-stop, shutter speed, and ISO in regards to how it affects an image. And so I think for those of you who aren't super used to using cameras and thinking about this, this really explains it really, really well, right? So you can see when the aperture is small, everything's going to be in focus, right? The foreground and the background, f1.4 lens, foreground, background, background gets blurry. So now, the lower the f-stop the lens is, the more expensive they are. So like an f1.4 lens can be pretty pricey. So, but in the end, for photogrammetry, you don't need that. You don't need a lens that goes down to f1.4 because ultimately, you want things as sharp as possible. And again, your shutter speed. So a slow shutter speed, you're going to get a lot of motion blur. So if you take the picture and your camera goes click, click, it's like, well, that's too slow. Because chances are you moved a little bit, something, you're going to get a soft photo. And the thing that I think we probably all know is when you use digital cameras or your phone and you take pictures and you look at them at the screen that's this big, you're like, that's sharp, that looks awesome. Take another picture, that's sharp, that looks awesome. Because you're looking at this tiny screen and then you get on your computer in Lightroom or Photoshop, you zoom in at 100% and it's blurry, right? So that's what we're trying to avoid is we want our photos to be sharp at 100%, which just means taking care with some of these things. And then ISO, again, you're adjusting the sensitivity of your CCD, but it's basically going to give you a lot of noise if the ISO gets too high. So I tend to keep it below 800.
Do you know the address of that on the web?
I do not. So, but you know, since this is being live streamed and the live stream is being recorded, you could always go to the live stream later and just sort of screen grab it from that. So, in regards to taking the pictures. So 10 degrees between each photo with a fixed point of interest. So this is a tree trunk that I did, and those blue rectangles represent where I took a photo. And so that's something that Photoscan ends up showing you once you process an asset. So 1 to 3 rows of photos depending on the object. A tree trunk doesn't really have a top and a bottom. It's a cylinder. And therefore, walking around this object and shooting a picture every 10 degrees works fine. You're going to basically capture what you need for the most part. And when I say 10 degrees, am I measuring that out? No. I was worried when I first got into this that you have to be super precise. You don't at all, right? So it's just like you're just kind of eyeballing it. Like the size of the object, my distance to go around this thing and take 36 pictures, I think it's one step, I think it's two steps. So you can see when you look at these, the spacing between them isn't totally even, because they didn't really measure out an accurate 10-degree arc around this tree, because then that would take forever if you had to do that, and you really don't. So something flat like a cliff face, you would only need 18 photos. And a lot of the cliff faces I did, I only had like 14 or 15, and they worked fine. So here are some trees that I've done. And so these, a lot of these are from Griffith Park. And so Griffith Park is only 20 minutes from here. And so I just waited for a cloudy morning, because as a lot of you who have ever shot textures before know that ideally you're shooting things on cloudy days, right? Because you really don't want direct sunlight on your objects. If you have direct sunlight on your objects, that's fine in regards to making the geometry, making the model, but it's bad for the texture. Because in your texture is going to have all the lighting baked in, the sunlight, the cast shadows, and all that stuff, and we really want to avoid that. So I waited for a day that was cloudy, which we've had a lot of those lately. And so in the morning on a cloudy day, I went to Griffith Park. As you'd imagine, there's hundreds of trees there, and I just walked around for like 4 hours, and just like, that tree looks cool, and just like walked in a circle around the tree, and then just looked around, and that tree over there looks cool, and walked up to it, and walked a circle, and it was an awesome, chill morning to just do that with headphones, and then basically I have those trees as assets now, which is really, really cool. And I think that for any of us who have tried to model and sculpt in ZBrush a rock or a tree, and texture it using textures from CG textures that we tile and then we lay stuff or whatever, it's like, and you think you did a good job, and then you look at these, it's just like, Jesus, these look nice. because it's reality, you know, and like the complexity of reality is just, this is not a tiling texture going all the way up that tree trunk, right? Like you can just tell, it's like, it's just different everywhere. To do that by hand, to sculpt that, I mean, we all know that sculpting on cylindrical objects is kind of a pain in ZBrush anyway, you know, because it's like sculpt, rotate. I mean, it's like, if you could rotate and sculpt at the same time, that would be awesome, but we can't yet. So these are really, really cool assets that, again, are millions of polys with 8K textures. They're super tack sharp if they're 4K, but they're technically 8K, what I'm getting out of Photoscan. So I can zoom in to these tree trunks pretty close. So it's really, really, really awesome. So in regards to shooting the photos, just some more info. This is Painted Canyon. And so here I'm just showing an asset that I just thought was a cool little area that I wanted to take pictures of. Now, things like a rock or a log that you find on the ground, you can pick it up and move it to the shade. Because sometimes it's cloudy and then the clouds go away. Like, what are you going to do with that? Well, if you just drove 4 hours, you're going to just kind of deal with it. And so ultimately, the answer in that is really look for things that are in the shade. Stop looking in the sunlight, look for things that are in the shade, and shooting objects in the shade works pretty well. So this object that I'm shooting, there's a little bit of sunlight hitting it there and there, but I'm actually really interested in this area down here. And if there's a little sunlight in the upper left corner, once I project the texture and I'm like, I can see the area that had sunlight, I can just clone it out. And so there'll be some cleanup on the texture. So here is what the photos look like for that asset. And so I'm just in Lightroom. And so you can see as I'm going around the objects, trying to roughly do a 10-degree per picture thing. And you can see what I mean by a fixed point of interest. So you can see it's this area that's in the middle there that as I walked around this object, I was kind of keeping that in the middle of my viewfinder. And so that I'm like interested in this specific area. And that's all I really needed with these photos. And so taking these photos didn't take long. And again, they're all shot in RAW on the 5D. And I'm exposing the image and looking on the viewfinder to make sure that the area I'm interested is exposed correctly, is bright enough. And so you can see down here that I've got a lot of relatively flat lighting because it is in the shade. So cloudy day is ideal, but things in shade really do work okay. So, and this is a V-Ray render of that asset. So here we have another thing. This is a rock. So like I just said, it was sunny on one side of the canyon, shade on the other side of the canyon. So I picked this rock up, moved over to the shaded side, propped it up, balanced it, and then walked around the object taking pictures. And it should be very apparent looking at these photos that I'm using the exact same exposure settings on all of the photos. So it's set to manual. And so as I go through that, so yeah, in these middle photos, the background gets super overexposed, but that's fine because it's the rock that's maintaining consistent exposure across all of the photos. Now, this is something, being a round object, that I wanted to be able to get the top and the bottom of it. And so for this, I realized one row wasn't going to cut it. So I walked around the object, shooting 36 photos from above a little bit, and then walked around it, crouching down, and shooting photos from below. And so this gave me two rows for this object. You kind of need to judge when you're taking the photos, is everything that you're interested in of that asset visible in the photos that you're taking, which is pretty straightforward. So, to recap a lot of the things I just said, so when you're outdoors, avoid direct sunlight, clouds, or shade. Studio lighting is possible for small to medium objects, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later. And so here what I'm saying is that you can grab things like a small rock, a small log, bring it back to your studio, and set up a, you know, indoor lighting setup to do photogrammetry. It just means that you want soft lighting. So the reason that we want to shoot on a cloudy day is you don't want direct hard light coming from a small light source, like I'm getting on me right now, where it casts really hard shadows. You want the sky as your light source, like an HDR. You just want this soft, huge light source coming from all directions that creates soft self-shadows and no obvious sharp reflections on the object. So if you're shooting in a studio, though, you will need to use strobes if you're shooting indoors. So if I was going to take a space like this and decide I want to set up a little photogrammetry area with lights, you can do that using large soft boxes to illuminate the object. And so at home in my garage, I've set that up. So I got some soft boxes and set up a little Lazy Susan, and I'll show you some pictures of that. But then you need remote triggers to trigger the strobes. You need to know how to use strobes. You need a tripod, Lazy Susan. Let me show you a photo. So this is what my garage looks like now that I'm into photogrammetry. So for this log, the thing is that it was so complicated, the shape of it from all angles, that it didn't seem like something that would work very well to shoot out like in the field. And it was only this big, and it was really light. So it was a really easy thing to carry or throw in a backpack and decide to capture later. And I could, therefore, by shooting it in a studio setting, make sure that I'm getting even lighting while also getting very sharp pictures and make sure that I'm really capturing this thing from every angle. So if you are interested in setting something like this up, I'll just say that it gets more expensive. Because if you just go outside with a camera using available light, you're just walking around things and grabbing assets like crazy. But with this, you do need, ultimately, as you can see, some more equipment. So what I have here is four soft boxes using Einstein strobes. They're relatively inexpensive strobes, but they are still like $400 a piece, and there's four of them in here. A Lazy Susan, this thing right here, painted white with 10-degree markings. I just ordered that off Amazon. It was black, and I painted it white. And so it's just a round disc that I guess people put on their dining tables or in cupboards, but it just spins around. And so that's something that's very, very useful. In the studio setting, I should point out that as opposed to in the field where you're walking around an object, in the studio setting, the camera is fixed and the object is spinning. The object is rotating, which Photoscan works very, very well with, which is kind of nice because you don't have to move. So, and then I have a white seamless backdrop. So the issue that I'm trying to achieve here in a studio setting is even lighting. So why do I have all of these lights from all these directions and why everything's painted white is I want soft, white, even lighting from all directions. And so soft boxes, most of these I ordered online. bhphoto.com is an awesome website for photo gear. And these are just light modifiers. So they're Einstein strobes with large modifiers on them. Here's another photo. And when I mention strobes, these lights are continuous lighting, right? So they're always on. Strobes are a flash, right? And so some of you who have tried photography may be very familiar with strobes. I wasn't really familiar with strobes when I got into this, so I kind of had to learn about the process, which was fairly straightforward. But ultimately, the issue is that I did have some softboxes that were continuous lights, right? 500 watts, 1,000 watts, flip them on, they're always on. We have a few of those because of the Gnomon workshop, right? So we're filming people drawings, we have some softboxes on them, and that works fine. They're always on lights. But the problem is they're only 500 watts or 1,000 watts, which sounds bright, but it really isn't. Because if in my garage I used continuous lighting and had to shoot photos for photogrammetry, it would be impossible for me to get the exposure that I really want for it to be bright enough and not really look noisy. It's possible, but I'd end up having to crank my ISO in order to get the exposure to look right. So what's amazingly cool about strobes is just that they only flash for a second, but they're really damn bright. These strobes can be brighter than the sun. So I could go outside with one of these strobes and flash it, and the picture will look like this picture of this person was shot at night, where the strobe is the only thing lighting them. That's how bright these things are. And so, which is pretty rad. And so what it means is that you can get an incredibly fast shutter speed with an incredibly low ISO of 100, with the f-stop being very, very high, so the picture is tack sharp. So what I learned by using strobes to shoot the photos with so much intense bright lighting hitting the object is that these photos with the camera on a tripod, when I zoom in at 100% in Lightroom or Photoshop, are razor sharp, completely in focus. Every little detail on the log, on the rock, or whatever is razor sharp at 100%, which, for the purposes of Photoscan, gives you a better model. And for the purpose of the textures, means you're going to get sharper, higher res textures. Then, the other thing that's really, really cool are these little guys, pocket wizards. They're remote triggers. So on my 5D, I have a pocket wizard, which is a transmitter, so that whenever I click my shutter, it sends a signal out to these pocket wizards that are connected to the strobes that are set to be receivers. They're all on the same channel. And so when I take a picture with my camera, all four strobes flash at the same time. And the nice thing is that it's all wireless. And so these little guys are about $125 on BH Photo. And then on my camera, I have a remote trigger so that I'm not touching the camera body when I take a picture, because that could produce a little bit of shake. And so by having a remote trigger, which just plugs into a jack on the camera, you have a little wire and you have a button in your hand, I just push the button, camera takes the photo, all of the strobes flash. Since it's all automated at that point like that, all I need to do is have my hand or my foot on the Lazy Susan and just button. Move, button, move, button, move, button, move, button. And that's how you're shooting the pictures. It's very fast. And so you'll see over here that on the Lazy Susan, there's little marks of tape and a little mark on the table right there so that I know that it's 10 degrees and I just know rotate, click, rotate, click. So here I'm showing photos that are shot in my garage of a log that's a birch log. And this is something that I really wasn't sure how Photoscan was going to do with. Because if you look at it, you can see that there's a lot of detail. And first of all, look at how sharp the photos are, which is pretty awesome. But this birch log also has bark that's peeling off. And would Photoscan be able to handle that? I wasn't sure yet. In the end, it did, which was amazing. And so you can see the photos look like. For this, it has a lot of photos. And so I have 36 photos for a top-down, straight-on, and below. So it's over 100 photos for this one asset. And so here I'm just going through the second row. At the end of that row, you can see there was a blank shot, and then going through, and then the top. The blank shot is necessary to create a mask in Photoscan, which you'll see later when we get into the whole issue of masking. It's a way for Photoscan to auto-mask things for you. If anybody has used Photoscan in here, knows about masking, you don't want to do it manually. So, the other issue is the raw image format. So, shooting in raw gives you an increased dynamic range. But the images are bigger. But that doesn't really matter because hard drives are cheap. So, and cards for your cameras are cheap. So you shoot in RAW, you have a higher dynamic range. And so when you shoot in RAW, you can adjust the exposure of your image after you shoot it. So just like HDRs. So we are used to HDRs having this huge dynamic range where you shoot like 12 stops of light information and merge it into an HDR. But ultimately, a RAW image on a Canon or a Nikon are basically kind of like a RAW image. So you have more light information than you see at one time. But it's really useful for delighting. And so there's multiple techniques out there for delighting. This is a solution I came up with as I was figuring it out on my own. It may not be the best, but it is really, really easy, which you'll see. So my workflow is after I have the photos that are all in RAW, Photoscan doesn't support RAW. You can't import your RAW images into Photoscan. So you have to convert them to TIFF. So I take my photos that I shot on my camera, copy them to the computer. They're all in RAW. They're all in Lightroom. I can then, and you can use any image editor that you want to browse them, but Lightroom is really easy. And so in Lightroom, I can just basically look at that directory of images of RAW files. Did I shoot a double photo here? That's junk. I need to delete that. Make sure the directory has the right photos in it. Then at that point, I export that as TIFF because Photoscan reads TIFF files. But I will then also export another version of those photos where I adjusted the exposure on them to try and reduce the lighting information, where I lower the highlights and I boost the shadows in Lightroom, and it flattens the image out to almost look de-lit. So Lightroom is the tool that I'm using for that. And so when I'm de-lighting the raw images in Lightroom, I can do it on one of the photos and then copy-paste what I did to that one to all 100 photos that are in the set. So you don't have to do it one at a time. So here, I'm going to show that process. And so here is that birch log. And so just zooming in on it, going to the Develop tab. And on the right side, you'll see there's an exposure slider. You also have highlights and shadows. And I'm boosting the shadows and then taking the highlights and lowering them down. And so ultimately, the image looks semi-delit. It's not, you know, technically, accurately, perfectly delit, but it's a great start point. And it actually looks perfectly fine for textures. So all of the renders I have of assets are really using this strategy. Because it's super, super fast. So one thing that I'd like to try is, like, you know, I think it was the Epic Kite demo where they sort of talked about how they did it, and they are shooting HDRs and chrome balls and using that to create the lighting information from that location to figure out how to delight. And I watched that and I was like, that looks complicated. So that probably is a much better way to do it, but this way is kind of fine. It really gives good results. So here I just copy and pasted the settings from that one to all of the other ones. So I'm just selecting all of the photos in that library. And then just right-click, paste, and I've now delit all of the photos for this asset. And then I can export that out as a directory of TIFFs. So I have two directories of TIFFs, one that are the raw photos converted to TIFF, one that are delit. So you can see here, as it loads in those settings, what it looks like after that process. So you get nice, flat lighting, which is really what you want. All right. So now we're moving to Photoscan. So Photoscan, as I mentioned, creates textured 3D models from photos. But the models that it creates in Photoscan are really, really heavy. They're millions of polygons. Now, it depends, again, on the megapixel of your camera. But you can end up with models in Photoscan that are millions of polygons. And so, and as you know, you don't necessarily want to bring that kind of stuff into a game engine or into Maya. Because Maya, once you have like 10 million polys in viewport, is not happy, right? So you can use proxies and use display layers. But ultimately, for the efficiency of a library, you need to decide what your polygon count is for your assets. And so you'll end up having to do that cleanup in a tool like Maya or ZBrush, and there's lots of tools for model cleanup. I use Maya and ZBrush. So you're going to ultimately have holes in the model from Photoscan because an area of the model wasn't in any of your photographs that you took, so it's going to have a hole. You have to fill that in ZBrush, sculpt on it. So Dynamesh and Remesher in ZBrush are freaking unbelievable for this process. So if this was like 3 years ago and we didn't have Dynamesh and ZBrush Remesher, I might have gone down this road and gone to ZBrush and was like, and just been like, oh, do I have to manually retopo this thing and so forth? Because that would slow things down a lot. But there's certain things where topology is really important, right? And there's certain things where topology being precise is less important. And when you're talking about a rock that's going to be on the ground over there, or a log that's going to be over there, do I need my topology to be perfect? Well, I'm not going to rig the thing, so I personally don't really care. And then I think, personally, ZRemesher does an amazing job of remeshing things to a target polygon count with an edge flow that's actually pretty accurate to the curvature changes of the model. And so I'm able to bring my models from Photoscan into ZBrush, remesh them, and UV them very, very quickly. And then I have to UV them and process normal maps. So I'm going to be showing you this process in Photoscan, so you'll see it. So these are the steps. So this is the order in which you do things when you are in Photoscan, meaning you start with your photos, which we've talked about, and then you get them converted to TIFF, you launch Photoscan, you import your photos, and you do this stuff in this order. So you got to build the heavy model in Photoscan. Then you've got to go over to ZBrush and Maya and clean it up. You're going to UV it. You're going to create a new model with a new topology that's heavy. Then you're going to bring that into Photoscan and project all the photos onto it to create your textures, because you can't project the textures until you have the final asset with UVs. Then you'll export that texture from Photoscan, clean it up in Photoshop, and then you've got your asset. So this is basically the workflow. So the Photoscan part. This is the order in which things are done in Photoscan. So step one, import the photos. Step two, mask it. This is an unfortunate part of Photoscan, but it actually doesn't take that long now that I've sort of figured out the workflow for it. Because if you read the manual, it makes it sound like you have to go click, 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 click around the object for every single photo, and then you want to like shoot yourself in the head. Because you read that in the manual, and you're just like, whoa, that's going to take forever for 100 photos. The reality is that that's not true at all, like at all. Because I tried to do that on the first one, and I was just like, this sucks. So I was just like, well, what happens if I just go click, 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 click around the object and do it super rough? It works totally fine on everything. So you have to create the masks. And then once you kind of what you're doing is you're basically telling Photoscan in a way what's important in the image. That's kind of what the masking process is. I'm interested in this rock. I'm interested in this tree. I'm interested in this part of the cliff face. Then it aligns the photos. So that's where Photoscan starts doing its photogrammetry math. That's amazing. It figures out where you were standing. It figures out 3D space from all of your photos. It creates all these points in space that represent that area. You build what's called a point cloud. So it's not polygons yet. It's not a mesh yet. It's just dots in 3D space that are colored with the color from the photograph. So it looks like a model that's textured, but it's really just a point cloud. Then from that, you build the geometry, which it does. It gives you the super heavy mesh. It has little floaty bits that you have to remove before you go to ZBrush, or else Dynamesh is not happy, which it has a tool for. And then you export a model. So here is Photoscan. So I imported those photos just using file import. And now I'm drawing the mask. Photoscan has a lasso tool. You can see it in the upper left corner is a lasso tool. And you can see how quickly I'm making these masks. So it's just going photo by photo, click, 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 click. And as you look at your photos, you'll have certain photos where I didn't even need a mask, because the object I'm interested in fills the whole frame, doesn't need a mask. But then as I get to the side, there's this tree trunk on the right, or on the left, that I don't want Photoscan to think about. And therefore, I'm masking out that area so that only the part that I'm interested in is going to be thought about, basically. So the process of making the masks for this cliff face is probably under 5 minutes or 3 minutes. This is sped up a little bit. So, but it's still click, 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 make mask, click, 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 make mask. Then you go to align photos. I'm using the default options, and they've worked for every asset I've done. It detects the points. It matches them. This process always goes fast. This process is always about a minute. So this is a quick part. And what you'll see when it's done is you have your camera, like the photos where you took them, and you can see this point cloud, but it's a very low resolution point cloud. And what you, which is why it goes fairly fast. And what you do at this point is you just have a bounding box, and you just use this little couple tools on the top left to rotate and scale the bounding box. You're just saying, this is the region of the point cloud that I want. Because in your photograph might be like some epic horizon that goes off 5 miles, and there's going to be a point like way out there. So you're just making a bounding box around the area, like, no, this is what I want you to think about. This is the part of the point cloud that I need. So how long does it take to do this part? This goes really, really fast too. And then you go to build dense cloud. I've been setting it to ultra high for everything that I've done, and this is where you wait. But not in a recording, because I paused it. And so you end up with something that looks like textured geometry, but you saw there when I zoomed in, it really is dots. It's dots in 3D space. And let me just go in here for a second and just pause this guy. And so for that, how long does that take, building the dense point cloud? Anywhere from 45 minutes to an hour has been what I've been getting on my computers. So I'm just using an Alienware machine. But since it does take, you know, an hour, and I had so many assets to process, I realized quickly that, like, all right, well, it doesn't take that long in Photoscan to, like, load them and make the mask, but it's going to take an hour, so am I only going to get 8 of these done a day? You know, well, that's kind of a drag. So the solution was have lots of computers. So I was working on 5 computers for, like, about 6 weeks, you know, just because then it's just like, you're building the dense cloud, and you're thinking about that, and you're exporting that, and that way I could really be cruising and cranking out assets. So once you have the dense point cloud, then underneath tools is a tool called Build Mesh. And so from the point cloud is where it's now going to build the heavy geometry. And so I can see in here that it's going to build a 8 million poly mesh. And I also should point out, by the way, that when you build a dense point cloud, what we're looking at right there, I set it to ultra high so I can get the highest resolution model as possible. That might not matter for what you're doing. If you're building low-res assets that you know are going to be in the background, you wouldn't set it to ultra high. You could set it to low or medium, and it's going to go way faster. But since I'm trying to build a library that's flexible, I'm trying to build myself a library where I have all sorts of assets that I can use at any time, where I need a rock, but oh, I want it to be close to camera. That's okay. It's a high-res asset. That's why I'm setting it to ultra high. So since I knew I could work on 5 computers at a time, I knew I could set it to ultra high, and it would be okay. So you have to figure out really an efficiency there. So then I say build mesh. You can see the dense cloud in the upper left corner is 39 million points. And it's going to give me an 8 million poly model. So now I just hit OK. Generating the mesh always takes about a couple minutes, fairly fast. And this is what the mesh looks like. So this is now polygons in Photoscan. And you can see the holes, which is where that region was missing from my photographs. That region just was not in any of the photographs that I took, because this was only one row. And I'll point out in there that something happened. I'm just going to go back a little bit. Let's go back a little bit more so I can pause. After you build the mesh, there is a tool in Photoscan called gradual selection. Because if I zoomed in to this model, there's certain areas in there that are just going to be little floating polygons, just like a little egg of polygons over here that's disconnected from the model. And you're going to have a few of them around. And if you ignore that and send it to ZBrush and Dynamesh it to fill the holes, then ZBrush thinks that those little things are important. And you get some janky results out of Dynamesh. So in Photoscan, this gradual selection tool is there to remove the floating polygons. So you just go to gradual selection, pretty much leave it at default. You'll see all the floaty bits get highlighted, and you hit the delete key. And then the floating polygons are gone, and you're safe to go to ZBrush and Dynamesh. So I'm saying OK, hit delete, and then I can export this model. So I go to File, Save, or rather export the OBJ. Leave everything at the defaults for exporting, and then export this model. And so the next step, obviously, is to go to ZBrush, but here's another example. Here for a tree, you can see how rough the mask is. And so this is a little bit more detailed than the last one, but still the mask process went fast. This is a single row walking around the tree. There is the point cloud. Now I'm building the high-res point cloud. There's your 8 million points. This one I didn't set it to ultra high because I was Camtasia recording for this demo. And sometimes you get floaty bits that you don't like. And the reason is that for trees, as it goes up from the trunk, now you have little branches and all these leaves. And that's something that Photoscan's not going to have much success with. Little tiny leaves, little spider webs, little things that are up there. So sometimes you get this noise. You can build the mesh from this if you want to, but it's easier in Photoscan to use the lasso tool and just lasso select those points that are floating out and delete them. You just select, delete key, select, delete key. So that's what I'm doing in here. So for the ground, I'm just cleaning it up so that my ground area is just going to be a nice circle. And so just working again on the dense point cloud. Those areas in there that are white is because like there's like sky behind that area, cloudy sky. So this process might take 5 minutes, it might take 10 minutes. And so areas where I just know the edge is going to be really messy, and I'd rather clean that up in ZBrush and Maya myself. And then once that's done, sort of cruise through, build the model. So here I'm generating the mesh from the dense point cloud. And then you can see the areas that had holes. Some of them it'll fill in, some of them it won't. And so that's some of the cleanup that I'll end up needing to have to do. Here I did the gradual selection thing to get rid of floaty bits. Here I'm zooming around trying to see if I can find a floaty bit to show you. And there I found one. And so then just hit the delete key. And once it looks good, export the OBJ. And then move on. So here, I'm showing the last example for Photoscan, which is something shot in a studio on a Lazy Susan. This is different. So when you walk around an object hand-holding, the mask can be really rough, as I just showed you, and you get good results. When the camera is not moving, and you have something on a Lazy Susan, with a background that's blank, right? It's just a solid white background behind this thing, then Photoscan is going to have a little bit more difficulty. And so it needs a precise mask. I couldn't tell you the mathematical reasons of why it does, but I've tested it. This is where the mask matters. You get some messy stuff if you don't have a precise mask, if stuff is shot on a tripod. So, but the issue, again, is making a precise mask that perfectly goes around the object. You don't want to do by hand. So what you want to do is when you shoot your first row of photos of an object, you then remove the object, right, and shoot the blank background so that you have a photo of what the background is behind that object without the object. And then you give that to Photoscan and say, hey, this is the background, so that it can do a difference. And so since Photoscan can then do a difference between all of your images that have this log and this blank shot of the background without it, Photoscan can make all the masks for you. And then it goes very quickly. So that's what's happening inside here. So you can see that here is the row for this log, and here is a photo that's blank, right there. And I have one for each row. So I'm selecting that row and saying import mask. And so on my hard drive, I have the background photo for each row in a folder. And so I'm going to the import mask tool in Photoscan, saying method from background, and telling it what the file name is of that mask that's on disk. There it is on disk. Selected camera, go. And now you can see it doing it. And so now you can see it's made this perfect, precise mask around the log. So as I go through the photos, I then am going to go to the next row, grab the background image for row 2, generate the masks. And then for some of these, you'll see there's some cleanup there. And so that's my girlfriend Liz's hair right there. And so, oh, and there's a log. But if we go back into that, let me go back to here, not this one. Let's go to there. All right, you have to clean that up. But that is really, really easy because, oops, doesn't like me pausing the video. Let's try that again. All right, that is really easy because you're just going to the lasso tool and just selecting that area and saying add to mask. Go to that area, add to mask. So it's basically doing 99% of the work for me. I just have to go through the photos and just see, do any of these need a little bit of cleanup? And then the process is the same. Align photos, build dense cloud, build model, gradual selection, export. So this process could be a nightmare, but Photoscan luckily has that import mask tool. So just remember, if you want to shoot on a tripod, it's awesome. Just don't make the masks manually. So as it goes through, let's just go and skip through some of that. A little bit more cleanup where I'm zooming in. Doing it for all the rows. And then there is the low-res point cloud for that log. And there's the geometry. So to me, I was insanely impressed that for this log with bark that's peeling off of it, that Photoscan was able to make that model. It's crazy. It's super cool. And so ultimately, there's a render of it. So that's after Photoscan to ZBrush, clean up, Maya, retop it, UV it, project textures, get into Maya, render it with V-Ray. But it's an amazing asset, right? But the thing is, like, I didn't make it. Like, a tree grew and died and dropped it. So, but now I have it as an asset. And so since that's how I got it, I don't mind just taking this asset and, like, throwing it on the floor in the corner of a scene. If I had modeled that and sculpted that and textured up my hand, I would be, like, in love with that thing, right? So, like, and all of a sudden, like, this is going to be in the foreground of the next image that I do. So that's another thing that's cool, is to just have, like, these super, super nice assets that you can use and populate a scene with. So after Photoscan, you then do need to clean this up. And so now we're moving into that phase of the process. And so the first thing I do is I go to ZBrush. And in ZBrush, you need to import the OBJ and follow these steps. So I'm going to show you images that illustrate this. But this is just like the general ZBrush workflow. So import OBJ, duplicate subtool. You need the original to stick around because you're going to use it for a projection, the high-res scan. Because these ultimately are scans. They're just scans from photos. Convert to Dynamesh to fill holes, because Dynamesh automatically fills holes in things, which is very useful. But then Dynamesh has really messy topology. So then Z-remesh it to get clean topology. Adjust the new topology if I need to. Subdivide my new model up to the polygon count of the scan, do a project so all of the higher frequency details from the scan go onto my retopologized model, and then add detail to areas that had holes using alphas, and at that point, I'm ready to get out of ZBrush. So what I have here is the OBJ model for this asset from Photoscan. And it's about 4 million polygons if I look up there. And so with that, I'll then duplicate it. And on the duplicate of that, so a duplicate subtool, I'll go to Z remesher and remesh it. I can't go straight to Dynamesh, even though I wish I could. But the reason I can't go straight to Dynamesh is because Dynamesh can fill holes, but it doesn't like flat objects very much, like an open-edged object, and it's going to try and close it in on itself, and you kind of get some wacky geometry. So what I do is I first Z-remesh it, not because I'm trying to get good topology so much, I'm just trying to get this thing to be something where I can guide Dynamesh on what to do later. So I Z-remesh it. Now it's only 40,000 polys. I really quickly jump over to Maya and use the bridge tool to fill these holes, because these will guide Dynamesh. That way, when Dynamesh fills the holes, I know it's going to fill the hole the way I want to by just putting these little strips in certain areas, which I found to be really helpful. And I take the edge loop around the whole thing by just double-clicking on it, selects the whole edge loop, and just extrude that out. And the reason I extrude it out is that when I use Dynamesh and it fills the holes, it's then going to fill the back and not go in on itself. But this process is just jump to Maya, bridge, extrude that out, back to ZBrush. So now I'm in ZBrush with the model that I adjusted in Maya. And you can see the little strips. And now I can go to Dynamesh. And Dynamesh then fills all those holes. Then I can Z-remesh. So now I've Z-remeshed where I now have a clean order topology. The topology is following the curvature changes of the model. And thank God for Z-remesher, seriously. I mean, I'm sure a lot of you have that feeling. It really is, for this, awesome. And so the polygon count that I Z-remesh, that is going to be a subjective thing that depends on where you're going to use your asset. Since I'm doing high-res renders in V-Ray, where I'm doing like stills for personal stuff, I don't really care about polygon count too much, so I'm okay making this asset 30,000 polygons, right, for this asset. If you're working in a game, obviously you may need it to be lower, but that's just going to be how you're going to adjust the way you retopologize this thing. So then, now that I have it, I just jump to Maya real quick and delete the back half that I don't need, because I did extrude this thing out and Dynamesh filled that hole in the back of this thing, and I just want to get rid of that, and the fastest way to me to do it is just to do it in Maya. So I just delete the back half, bring that back into ZBrush, and then turn on the subtool that I kept around of the original scan. So now that's what I'm seeing. So I have the scan from Photoscan visible as a subtool, as well as this new piece of geometry that I Dynameshed and Z-remeshed. I then have to subdivide my new piece of geometry to be roughly the same number of polygons as the scan, so that I can use the project button in ZBrush, where it projects all of the detail from the scan onto my new model that has good topology and all the holes are filled, which is then that. So what we're now looking at basically looks exactly like the scan. It just now has the topology that I need, which is great. And so this workflow is very linear. It's very straightforward. And so it's basically do this. All right, next rock. This. It's pretty much a very linear, straightforward workflow. But for the holes, like up there, zooming in on it, when you use project in ZBrush, sometimes you do get little janky things, like up there. It's like all these little like whacked out little polygons. So, and the edge of this looks a little rough. So I just grab the smooth tool or the smooth brush in ZBrush, and I just smooth out that area that I now need to add detail to, because again, it was a hole. So how do I get the detail in that area? Well, I don't want to sculpt because that's slow. And so what I want to do is use alphas. I have a big library of alphas that I've made from scans. And so because what's rad is that I can have this model of this cliff face or of this rock or whatever, in ZBrush, I can make my canvas 2K by 2K, put that rock, cliff face, whatever, fill the canvas, and just grab doc. And now I have the depth information of that asset, and that is now a 16-bit grayscale alpha. And so I've built myself a big library of 16-bit grayscale PSDs from doing GrabDoc and ZBrush off of these rocks and cliffs and tree trunks and things that I've been making to create a big alpha library. So what's useful about that is I can then go to the standard brush with the drag rectangle tool, grab these alphas, mask this area, and just drag some alphas on it. And so, and since all of these alphas are coming from scans, they look good, they look really good. And what I found to work really well is to grab doc off of this asset, right? So if I go somewhere else on the asset, pick an angle, grab doc, create an alpha, go to the area where the hole is, and use that alpha to fill detail in the hole, it matches, because the detail is in the same form language as that alpha has, right? So I've done that on a lot of tree trunks, because there's so many different types of bark. But I go to another part of the tree, it's the same kind of bark, grab doc, now I have a perfect bark alpha for that area that I need to fill a hole in. And so now I've filled in the holes. So here, in the end, what I have is I have a 19,000 polygon version of this asset, where I'm happy with the topology, it's fine. I have the 4.5 or 5 million poly version of it with the ordered topology. So this is the SDiv 1, this is the SDiv 5. So at SDiv level 5, it looks like the scan. SDiv 1, that's my base mesh. And then what I do from there depends on your workflow. If I'm working in V-Ray, I might export a displacement map that represents the difference between the two. If you're in games, you'll use a normal map. Sometimes I use displacements and normals. But that is the next step. But before I can make a displacement map or a normal map, I need my UVs to be laid out. So I use Hedis UV layout. Maya's UV tools have gotten a lot better, but I started using Hedis a long time ago, and I still find it to be super easy. So I lay out the UVs relatively quickly. And then now I have my model, and I can create the normal map. And so the normal map, I create an X normal. So that means that if I'm creating a displacement map, as you all would know, 32-bit displacement export from ZBrush, if it's a normal map, I export the SDiv 1, which is 19,000 polys for this asset. I export the SDiv 5, which is 5 million polys. So I have the low-res mesh and the high-res mesh. Save those to disk, go to X normal, and it gives me an awesome normal map, which is the difference between the low and the high. So those of you who have used XNormal know what I'm talking about. Those of you who have tried to use ZBrush to make normal maps know that they're a little soft, so ZBrush normal maps aren't awesome. But XNormal is free, and it's really cool. So I've got that. So this is XNormal. If you haven't seen it, it's free. It's a very straightforward tool to use. You just say, here's my high res, here's my low res, give me a normal map. And that's it processing a normal map right there. And so now I have my new model from ZBrush that's been cleaned up. It's been UV'd. But now I need to project the photos onto that object to get my texture map, because that's still a process we haven't done yet. So I export from ZBrush the UV'd high-res model, and I import that into Photoscan. And so the model that Photoscan made is still in Photoscan. You've got to delete it. Bring your new one in from ZBrush. That's your final asset. And then project the photos, where I swap the images in Photoscan to the ones that are delit, where I adjusted the exposure settings. And then you got to clean it up, and I'll explain that later, because that probably makes no sense right now. So this is me in Photoscan. There's the model Photoscan made. I go to remove model, right click. Then I go to import, and I import the mesh that I exported from ZBrush, the high-res mesh. That's going to come in. It'll plop in at the exact same spot, as long as I didn't move it in ZBrush, which I don't do. And then, once it's in there, all you need to do is project the photos. So, workflow, build texture, keep UV, and for me, I set it to 8K. So even though I know that the photo or this texture I'm going to get ultimately at 8K might be a little soft, I still like to do it at 8K, and then I can resize it to 4K in Photoshop, and it's going to be really, really sharp. So keep UV, texture size 8192 by 8192. This process goes very fast, usually takes about a minute. And then up at the top here, you have display modes in Photoscan, so like, you know, wireframe, shaded. This one is shaded with textures, so I'm just clicking on that. And there it is. So now I'm seeing my model with a texture. So it's just amazing that Photoscan is projecting all of these photos together and blending them all together and giving you a texture map. So areas that had holes, the texture is going to be black. But that, as you know, is fairly straightforward stuff to clean up in Photoshop with a clone tool. So I'm going to Tools, Export Texture, exporting that to the right spot as an 8K texture, exporting it as a TIFF. Let's sort of scrub through that. Save it out. Jump over to Photoshop, load it in, and that's what you get when you load it into Photoshop. But that's actually not what you want. And so this became a sticking point for a little while of like, that's weird. Like, as far as like no edge blending, even though the manual talks about edge blending, and so it's sort of like bleeding the edges out on the UV shells. What you get when you load the TIFF, and I tried all the file formats and I Googled like crazy, and you load this TIFF file into Photoshop, and it looks like all you have is a layer with transparency. So, and somebody maybe has an alternate approach to this, which if you do, I'd be really happy to hear. But the workflow in the end that I was not able to figure out in Photoshop for some mysterious reason that I still don't understand, how to get the edge bleed information that Photoscan does generate in here. And so the solution, weirdly, is to actually, because you can see there's no alpha channel or anything like that where that information seems to be hiding. But if you open that image in XnView, which is a free image viewer, and so I just, you know, XnView is what I use anyway as an image viewer. So I tried loading the image into XnView just to see what it looked like, and it looked the same way. But then in XnView, you can go and say, under the View menu, I'm about to move it so you can see it. If you go to the View menu and turn off Use Alpha Channel, that's what you want. And so you can see that Photoscan actually does bleed the edges out. And so that is important because when you put this on, especially if you have multiple UV shells, based on how you laid the UVs out, you're going to get little seams without the edge bleeding. And so point being is Photoscan does give you your UV shells with the bleed in there. I just can't figure out how to get Photoshop to read the damn thing. So I go to XnView, sound the same. Turn off the alpha channel, re-export it as a TIFF, and then load that TIFF into Photoshop. And then there you go. So now I have the texture from Photoscan, and it's ready to clean up. And ultimately, when you look at it, the obvious thing is that area was getting sunlight. So that's obviously the area that I'm going to go in and clean up. And this process is straightforward texture stuff. As far as using the clone tool, looking for areas that have a little blur. I still have the alpha channel in there that I can use as reference of where I have cleanup to do. But with natural things like tree bark and rocks and ground and dirt and mud, I found that I can be really, really sloppy with the clone tool when I'm trying to clean these things up. And so ultimately, it's a matter of going in and just going all over the place with the clone tool. So this is everything that we just did. Clone into the shadows, clone into sunlight areas. And so the next little video, we're going to be doing that. So I'm going to make a new layer, grab the clone tool, pick a random area, and just clone. So you can be as anal with this as you want. You could use other photos that you have from the shoot that you're going to go and clone from. But with the number of assets that I was creating, I didn't really want to be too anal about it. So what I find is, like, I prefer to be really sloppy with this kind of stuff and bang it out. And then down the road, when I do actually use this asset in an image, I can place it in the set where I need to do my render for my final thing, and I may never notice that that needs any work. Or at that point, I can decide, oh, I need to clean up the texture on that thing a little bit more. So here's the same thing for a tree. Let me go back a little bit. So you can see for the tree, this is what the texture looked like from Photoscan. So you can see the tree trunk bits that are going up high into the leaves were getting really, really black and missing information because they're above me. And so Photoscan wasn't able to see the top of the tree branches that are up there. So that's something that definitely needed some cleanup. So new layer, clone tool, and just real quick, clone into those areas. Now, since I'm fixing it in Photoshop and cloning over the edges of a UV shell, clearly there'll be a seam. But again, like what I said before, I don't care about the seam because nobody may ever notice it. And if I do notice it in an image down the road, I'll just fix it in Mari. So here's something that was shot in sunlight, but I thought it was cool, so I wanted to shoot it anyway. So this is how I just approach cleaning that up. Let me go back a second. I take the image that has shadows, I make it grayscale, I bump the contrast up so I can isolate the shadows, and I use this as a mask. So now that I have that as a mask, I can load it, save it as an alpha channel, and load it as a selection. Once I have that as a selection, I can grow the selection out a little bit using the grow selection tool in Photoshop. Test it. So test that when I paint into it, I'm just painting where the shadows are. And then I'm just expanding it. So select, modify, expand that selection. And once it looks like that mask that's isolating the shadows is working pretty well, I then just go crazy with the clone tool. And then just start cloning, cloning, cloning. Just being random about it. And in the end, it's actually a pretty fast way to flatten the lighting on that thing. It's sloppy, but it does work. And so there's another object that I did the same thing. So once you have your textures, then you set up the model material in Maya or V-Ray. So import the base mesh into Maya, set up your lighting, set up your materials, render the image, add it to the library, I have a new asset, and export the model by itself to use down the road. So that is pretty much the photogrammetry part of things. So what we're going to do going forward is I'm just going to talk about getting into Maya, using these assets and organizing them, and then I have the image that I showed earlier where I'm just going to show a kind of like sort of step-by-step sort of how that came together. So that's kind of where we're at. And so in Maya, I just load in the texture that I made from Photoscan, load in my normal map from XNormal, make a simple V-Ray material and physical sun and sky and do a render. And then once I have that render, I can just go and adjust the settings on my V-Ray material to get this to look like the kind of rock or stone that I wanted to have. I know that generally I just want my glossiness to be like around 0.25 to 0.4. There's no right answer. There is no right answer for what the glossiness is for a stone because there's so many different types of minerals and stones and rocks that have the whole gamut in regards to glossiness. So it's personal preference, really. How shiny do you want this rock to be? So I just give it a ballpark area because I'm building an asset for my library right now. So at least it has a V-Ray material that's kind of blocked out to be a stone material so that when I save this asset to my library by itself, I know that down the road I can import this into any project that has a V-Ray material, it's got its normal map, it's got its texture, and it's ready to set dress another scene. Also, when I create my assets in their scenes by themselves to set up the materials, I do work at real-world scale. So this little stick that I have is 180 centimeters tall, so roughly the height of a person. So by making my entire library at the same scale, that basically means that if I always work at the same scale, I know that when I am working and I went, oh, I need a tree, and I import a tree, it's going to come in at the right size. I need a rock, it's going to come in at the size that that rock was that I thought it needed to be. I might scale rocks up and down a bit, but it just makes my life easier to know that everything's consistent. So once I have that asset and it seems to be good, I will save this render to my images directory for my project. I have a project directory for Maya called Photogrammetry. In that scenes directory are all my photogrammetry assets that I've built in the Maya files for them. In the images directory, I have renders of them where the render is the name of the scene file, so that I can browse my image directory for this Maya project and see all my photogrammetry assets and be like, I want that cliff, and then file import the scene file for that, which is called Ladder Canyon Cliff B Alone. So that means the only thing in that scene file is the model with its material and textures. So building a library is useless if you're not organized, right? You're never going to, you don't want to be like, I need a spring. 3 years ago, I modeled a spring. What project was that for? And then start digging through your Maya projects to try and find that thing, because that really is going to slow you down. So taking the time to be organized is a time-consuming thing to do, but ultimately it saves you so much time down the road. So I'm very anally organized with my naming conventions for my library. So I have a Maya project called SpeedTree, a Maya project called Onyx, a Maya project called World Machine, a Maya project called Photogrammetry, and so forth, so that I know that's where those assets are, and where the images are, and where the scene files are. So this is the images directory for my photogrammetry project. And so in here, you can see that I just have renders of these different elements so that I can easily import them into another scene later. So just all sorts of different cliff faces, logs, rocks, and so forth, a skull, trees. And so with all of these things, I'm also showing you SpeedTree folder, all the renders of my items by themselves, ready to import into other scenes, and so forth. And what I'm showing here is what my Maya scenes directory looks like. So here would be Cliff Indian Canyon B. That's the Maya file that has physical sun and sky and lighting, and I'm blocking out the shader and the materials and making sure it looks right and doing render tests. Underneath that, I have Cliff Indian Canyon B alone. So I selected that model, file export, export that model to disk by itself so I can just import it later. Because you don't want to import the one that has the lights in it. Because then every time you import an asset, now all these lights are coming in and all this stuff that you don't want that are going to screw your scene up. So we've kind of gone through that whole process of photogrammetry, Photoscan, ZBrush, cleaning stuff up. I know it's a lot of information, but again, this is being recorded, so you guys can scan through it later if you're interested. But now we're going to move on to that image I showed earlier and talk about layout. And then you'll see how these photogrammetry assets kind of got used. So for this, the first thing that I think about, if I'm going to do a personal piece, just to sort of keep things simple, is what aspect ratio do I want to work at? What's my composition going to be? Where's my camera going to be? And I block out things really, really easily and simply. And so the image that I showed earlier was something where I actually, or literally, just had this photogrammetry asset in Maya, and it was just like, I'm going to make an image with this somehow. So I'm just going to use this asset to try and come up with an image that ideally will be kind of inspired by Ladder Canyon and Titus Canyon. It was kind of the hope. And so I took that model, I rotated it, created a physical sun and camera, adjusted the light position, and did a render. And so this ultimately told me, like, I'm going to try and make a Titus Canyon type kind of ravine thing that goes off into the distance. So I'm going to have cliff walls on either side. So I kind of knew that's where I was going. And so ultimately, this one photogrammetry asset, I then sort of built an image off of. And so what I'm showing here is something that's important to remember, is that these assets you create, whether it's a cliff face or a rock or whatever, you're welcome to tweak it however you want. So here I'm putting a lattice on it, grabbing some lattice points, and I'm just going to adjust the shape on it. I could use like a bend deformer, a twist deformer, and so forth, any kind of deformers to adjust these things. So I could have a flat cliff wall, put a twist deformer, and turn it into a cylinder, have it turn a corner, model it more and adjust it in ZBrush. Because when I put it to the left of frame, I just wasn't happy for whatever reason about how the angle was going, and I wanted to adjust that. So here, what I'm showing is like with the lattice and without the lattice. So without the lattice, it looked like that. with the lattice, I ended up just sort of moving it out of frame. So I'm just selecting the lattice and turning it on. So just a simple lattice adjustment. Lattices are super useful in Maya as modeling tools. And then that's the second lattice I put on top of it, just to get it to flow with the composition better, which is all very subjective. And then I decided to add some other objects. So I made a decision to work at 50% scale. Can't remember why, but basically inside here, I remember that that was something where, I can remember why. At real world scale, based on wanting to have a canyon that goes off to the distance, where we're going to see some little mountain thing that's maybe like a mile or 2 miles or 10 miles away. If your Maya scenes, if you work at real world scale, get too big, viewport bugs out. You start getting weird artifacts in viewport if your scene is just too large in real world scale, and that bugs me. And so if I work at 50% scale, I know my scene won't be as big. I ideally won't get OpenGL artifacts. And so if I just make a decision that I'm going to work at 50% scale, then whenever I open assets from my library, I know just open it up and scale to 50%. Open it up and scale to 50%. So, and then I started blocking out some simple shapes as I work on composition. So something that a lot of people forget is that before ZBrush, you did have sculpting in Maya, which sucks compared to ZBrush, but you can do it. And so I do it all the time. So I made a plane, subdivided to 100 by 100, and then with that plane in here, I can use the sculpt geometry tool. And so going to polygons, mesh, sculpt geometry, you can push out, push in, adjust the brush radius, hold down the B hotkey to change the size. And then in Maya, I'm sculpting. The reason sculpting in Maya is useful is because, again, I started by figuring out my aspect ratio, my camera position. I need to work the camera. And you can't do that in ZBrush. ZBrush does not have a true 3D camera. And so since my final rendering is going to be in Maya from V-Ray, it's just a lot easier to block things out in Maya that way. So I'm making something that ultimately looks like this blobby thing, but I know that I'm going to then bring it to World Machine, bring it to ZBrush, detail it later. So I'm really just focusing on composition. Where are things? Simple things that I can make very, very quickly. And so that way, you're focusing on really what will have much more of an important effect on the quality of the image at the end than how well something is ZBrushed or how detailed something is as far as texture. So here you can see these really, really simple objects that are inside there, all made in Maya with the sculpt geometry tool, so that what I end up with in my shot camera, you know, is pretty much what the image is going to end up looking like, but my time investment is only maybe an hour or 40 minutes, or whatever time it takes to just block out cubes, cylinders, spheres. This is a boulder. This is a simple thing with a sculpt geometry tool. And then I can start detailing all that stuff. So here's an initial World Machine pass on the far geometry. So I just took that, sent it over to World Machine, and detailed it. And what I'm showing you is the way to do that. So if you've used World Machine, you know that it's a tool for basically creating height maps or displacement maps. So imagine World Machine, everything is a plane. You use procedurals, fractals, Perlin, all that kind of stuff, and you create these terrain shapes, but it's all off of a flat plane, and what you export from World Machine is a grayscale image, right, which is a displacement map to create a terrain. That's basically what you're doing. So the issue is like, well, then how do I sculpt that in Maya but still be able to go to ZBrush, because you can't import geometry into World Machine and work on it. But what I can do is take that mesh that I made in Maya, bring it into ZBrush, look straight down on it with no perspective orthographically, and grab doc. Because that then grabs the height information of what I sculpted in Maya, and then I can take that grayscale image that's the height information of that thing that I made in Maya and send that to World Machine, and then put the erosion node on it and have something that looks amazing just because of the erosion node. So in here, threw a texture on that thing, adjusted the light angle, put some shadow objects off camera because I wanted this area to be in shadow. So here I'm selecting some objects. Let's see which one this is. Give me 1 second just to be like, where are we going? Yeah, what I'm showing here now is based on that previous slide saying things that are off camera. This is a really important thing to actually point out. My camera is down there looking this way, but I have all the stuff that's behind camera. Very often I see, you know, with students, scenes that they're only focusing on what's in front of the camera, but not what's outside of frame behind. Now that we're using global illumination renders, pretty much everybody, then your objects are based so much on reflectivity that what's behind camera is extremely important to the lighting that you get of what's in front of the camera. And so if I don't want it to look like there's bright sky behind the camera flooding this canyon with light, I need to put some cliffs and trees and things behind the camera to block that light from being visible in the reflections. So that's what that stuff is inside there. So there's my scene. All looks pretty straightforward. Let's zoom forward. So now that I've added another piece of geometry there with the Sculpt Geometry tool, added another one. So it's starting to look pretty much like what the overall layout of the final image is. Did some in the lower right corner. And then I did a World Machine pass on that piece. And then a ZBrush pass on this piece. ZBrush pass on the ground in there. Added some cavity maps on those pieces. ZBrush pass on this guy on the right. And you will notice that I am breaking this thing into pieces. That's very intentional, because I know if I do the whole thing as a single piece of geometry, I'm going to have polygon issues in ZBrush. I'm going to want to subdivide this thing more, and I'm not going to be able to, because then it's going to become 200 million polys, and it's a drag. So by working in Maya 2 camera, it makes it easier for me to block and cut this thing up into pieces based on how much I think I'm going to have to subdivide it in ZBrush. Here, I made an adjustment on the upper right corner using a lattice, for whatever reason. ZBrush pass on this boulder right there. ZBrush pass on the ground. And now I'm going to show the ZBrush thing of making those alphas. If you want to make an alpha, let me move that, from what you have with a piece of geometry in ZBrush, the first thing is there's no reason for your alphas to be bigger than 2K. A 2K alpha, 2,000 by 2,000 pixels, is 4 million points of information, right? So if you had a plane in ZBrush and you subdivided it to 4 million polys and you took a 2K alpha and dragged it over the entire thing, it would be clean, right? So you have to be thinking how much surface area am I going to drag this alpha out over, and that tells you what the resolution of your alpha should be. But if your alphas are higher res than 2K, they're going to get slow in ZBrush. So I make my canvas size 2K. I did a grab dock. Right there, you can see the grayscale height information from what was on campus or canvas. Then with the standard brush, I'm switching to drag rectangle and dragging that out to have an alpha. And then I can go and use radial fall off here just to show that it can fall off. Now, I really don't like radial fall off because it's too perfect and round looking. So what I end up actually doing for my library is I take all of these alphas that I'm doing from GrabDoc, bring them to Photoshop as 16-bit, and just grab a black brush and paint the edges out to be non-perfectly round, but it still fades at the edges. So here I've got this object, spinning it around, zoom in, find an area that I think could make a cool alpha. And then grab doc. I have another grayscale 16-bit image that I can then switch over to this plane subtool and with drag rectangle, test it out. And something that's a very, very useful tip, I gotta take this off because I'm boiling, is if you use drag rectangle with a 2K alpha, it might seem slow. Go to the stroke palette and turn off lazy mouse. Lazy mouse has no purpose with drag rectangle whatsoever, but for some mysterious reason, it's on by default when you use drag rectangle. And the performance hit is massive. Because if you have like a 5 million or 20 million poly model and a 2K alpha and the drag rectangle tool and you try and drag it out, it's going to chug. Turn off lazy mouse, it'll be real time. So just anytime you use drag rectangle in ZBrush, turn off lazy mouse. It really makes a big, big performance jump. So here I'm dragging that out, and then I can see just like how simply I can start creating really cool alphas. So here what I'm showing is the grab docs that I've done off of like rocks and stuff like that. But they don't fade at the edges. And so here I'm showing a folder called Cliffs Fall Off. So each one of these I opened in Photoshop and just painted the edges to black. Because again, radial fall off looks funny. So if all of your alphas have a round fall off and you start dragging them off, it looks really hilly and doesn't look really nice. And so by taking the time to modify my alpha library, you get much, much better results. So I also put all of my alphas in the directory where ZBrush is installed so that when I use Spotlight in ZBrush, I can access them very, very quickly. So going to Lightbox, you can see that if I go to my alpha tab right there in Lightbox, you can see I have Bark, Cliffs, World Machine, Scan Data Alphas, and so forth. So I can double click on one of those and have very, very quick access to a bunch of alphas. These are alphas that I made with a plugin for Photoshop called Filter Forge, which is awesome. And so I just have lots and lots of alphas that are all pretty organized. Another thing that you can do, which I did right there, which I do a lot as well, is that if you go to the Lightbox folder in the ZBrush installation directory, and that's where you put your alphas, you have to use Lightbox, browse, double-click on one to load it in. Didn't load in. Double-click on it. Didn't load in. Double-click on it. It's like this weird thing with Spotlight that it doesn't always load when you double-click. It's kind of annoying. So what I like to do is go to the Z startup directory, put the alphas there and restart ZBrush. So like if I know I'm going to be using these 10 alphas or these 20 alphas or these 50 alphas, I'm going to use all of my Cliff scan data alphas in this session, put them in the Z startup directory, in the alpha directory, restart ZBrush, and then when I click on alphas, they're all already loaded. You know, so that I can just go click, grab that alpha, click, grab that alpha, click, grab that alpha, and work. So I don't have to go like double click, double click, double click, double click to try and load all these into ZBrush. So that's really, really useful. So there, I'm turning off radial fall off. So you can see that ultimately they look better without that radial fall off. You just get something that's going to blend together across them in a much better way. So here I'm just grabbing random alphas onto that plane. And so that literally in, you know, 5 seconds, because it's literally that long, it's like alpha drag, alpha drag, alpha drag, rocky looking floor thing. Which is really cool. So like you're still art directing it. It's like you still did the scans and made the alphas and decided which area you thought was cool, and you still are deciding which one to grab and how to rotate and scale. It's like you're still art directing, but you know, in the end, it's really, really fast. So do you get credit for how cool that looks? It's like, I don't know if I do. In a way I do. So, but in a way I really don't. But it's still super cool and fun and valuable. So here I'm just showing all the different pieces that have been ZBrushed and what they end up looking like in Maya. And so where I'll export from ZBrush the model that has been worked on, an SDIV level, create a normal map, an X-normal, so that it's ready to render. So this is what the ZBrush file looks like for this project. So here I'm just selecting different tools. So if I grab the ground in there, I'm just showing what that looks like. And then here I'm grabbing drag rectangle, going to alpha, grabbing some random alpha. I tend to set the vocal shift to a negative value to get less of a bump, have it be more flat. And then I can just adjust my Z intensity and just start dragging that in different areas to create rocky forms. So, like, a tablet was not used in the making of this image at all, right? Because when using drag rectangle, you don't really need a tablet. It's like it's really just the mouse and dragging, and that's fine. So it's really not sculpting. Just showing different pieces. So I'm only sculpting on the part of that that's visible to camera. And then here is another example scene. So this is a different image, one that I showed earlier. And for this one, so I have to go forward for that to play. This is what I made in Maya. So, like, anybody could make that very quickly. It's just some flat planes with a sculpt geometry tool. So it's all about camera composition, pick a lens, where's the camera, and make simple shapes. And so making those really doesn't take long. Breaking into different pieces so I'll have good polygon count in Maya or in ZBrush, and really taking the time in Maya to, like, is this the composition I want? Is this where I want things to sit in frame before I go to ZBrush? And it's a fast process. So that when I go to ZBrush, what I have is very simple looking. But then by grabbing all those alphas that I've made in my library, I can then just drag them onto these surfaces and ultimately get pretty natural looking rocky forms pretty fast. So if I look at any one of these shapes inside here and, like, thought about, like, how long would it take me to sculpt that with, like, the standard brush? Standard, pinch, damn standard, whatever, it's like, that would be like an epic sculpting session where I would just, you know, it would be very time consuming. Because, you know, it's something that is fine, and sometimes you'll have no choice but to do that if you have very specific art direction and you're not going to just be able to go scan it. But for something like this, it works really well. And so that's what the Maya file looks like. For this one, I was lazy and used Decimation Master. So you can see they're super heavy. Just some extra geometry outside of frame to make sure I don't have too many bright sky reflections coming into the front of the image. A tree that I made in SpeedTree. Some random rocks that I placed, which are photogrammetry rocks. And then physical sun and sky with V-Ray. And then a little bit of, you know, color tweaking and adjusting levels and stuff in Photoshop. So back to this guy. Texturing materials, V-Ray materials, textures. I do use CG textures sometimes if some things aren't photogrammetry based, meaning this guy on the left is from a photo scan, right? It has a texture. This stuff I made in ZBrush, it doesn't have a texture. So for that, I might use textures from photogrammetry stuff, but not so much because they're not really set up to be tiled. So ultimately, CG textures is awesome. Like, I have tons of great rock and cliff textures that are tileable from there. And so I tend to build tileable shader networks so that I really can sort of load in a library of cliff, rock, and boulder shaders that are already set up and set to be tileable. And then I can just adjust the repeats on a shared 2D placement node across all the textures to adjust how the scale is working. So these are some textures from cgtextures.com, which I think they just renamed it textures.com. And they're tileable. And another thing that I've been using a lot lately is Megascans, which is coming from Quixel. It's a library of tileable 4K, 8K, unbelievable quality textures that have the normal map, translucency maps, gloss maps, AO maps and everything for all of these photogrammetry acquired textures. And Megascans is awesome. So this is what Megascans looks like. So this is what the website looks like. These are textures from the Megascans library that I downloaded off the website. And so these are preview renders that they give you for the textures. And they're really, really cool. And so for any of them, if I go into the folder, you can see they have the normal, they have the diffuse, and these are all really, really easy to use, and it's just awesome that they're 4K and tileable. So for rocky things, cliffs, landscapes, I've been using these a lot. So let's cruise through there. You can just showing a lot of variety of Megascans. And again, that's from Quixel, the guys who make Endo and Dido. So end up with a bunch of materials. Like I said, tile textures to block things out. Blended V-Ray materials using snow as a slope mask. That's a really good Maya trick. The snow procedural is a slope angle mask. So with V-Ray blend materials, I can create a snow shader and make it black and white. And then basically I can just have something where it's flat, it's white, where it's vertical, it's black, have threshold, and use that as a mask with a V-Ray blend material. So I can say the tops of my rocks are dusty, but the sides aren't. Or the tops of the rocks are sandy, but the sides are more rocky. I use the snow procedural to make that blend. So World Machine has slope angle, and people think Maya doesn't, but it does. It's just called snow. I also paint textures as masks for the blend materials. Now I'm instancing small rocks and boulders. So now I'm set dressing. I have a library of rocks. This is just a test render for my library. And so what I'm showing here is how I populate a scene with that stuff. So there's a script called SPPaint, which is on Creative Crash. So SPPaint is a free script for Maya. It's super, super cool. So basically, you can just have a library of little rocks like this, or trees, or blades of grass, or whatever it is. Launch the SPPaint script. Select the geometry you want to paint on. Select my little rocks. Say that that's the brush geometry. Tell it that I want to randomize the rotation in X, Y, and Z as I paint. Zoom in, and then just start painting. So it's geometry paint. Super, super useful. So as you use the SPPaint script, it's randomly selecting from whatever you gave it. So if you gave it 20 rocks, it's going to randomly select from those rocks and rotate them. So there's other ways to randomly place geometry in a scene, but SPPaint is the most precise. You can do particle instancing with particle emission off surfaces. That's a little bit more fulfilling very large areas. And so here we can see some of those elements, and you can adjust the scale and the size. And the thing that's important to note is that the SPPaint script, you can set it to make instance copies. So as you paint, the duplicates that it's creating aren't real duplicates, they're instance copies sharing the same shape node, meaning that I have no limit on polygon count. So even though these little rocks are like maybe 1,000 or 5,000 polygons each, I can just go in there and just like paint like a maniac. And just like, I'm at 1 million polys, I'm at 10 million polys, I'm at 50 million polys, doesn't matter, it'll render. So, because again, I've gone up to 15 billion and it worked, and I haven't tried going higher than that. So as long as you're instance copying, you can copy stuff like crazy, which is really, really cool. So eventually OpenGL or your viewport might get a little slow, so I'll change those objects to bounding box, so that at least I can still tumble and navigate the scene. So now I tweaked that geometry in the background, added a new boulder on the ground, adjusted this geometry in the background in ZBrush, switched to a 2K render, and have populated some photogrammetry elements. So some boulders, a little log, tree trunk on the right. So the cool thing is as I'm now finishing layout on this image and I want to set dress, I can now go through my library and grab different pieces to put in there. Then just doing a little tweaking in Photoshop as far as color and adding a sky. Using a ZDepth pass to add a little bit of fog into the scene. Just plopping a little Googled campfire, grabbed a little campfire image and put that in there. Googled smoke, grabbed an image of smoke, plopped that inside there. Some little bushes. Final tweaks, decided to add a little bird on the ground. This is all in Photoshop. New texture back there. And then final adjustments to up-res this to 4K. 3840 by 2160, that's the resolution of 4K TVs. And so 4K TVs now are that resolution, so that's kind of my new. I used to do a lot of things at 1920 by 1080, targeting HD, and now that we have 4K TVs coming around, this is like the new resolution that I'm kind of trying to target because it's great for displaying images like on screens. So like we have a new space upstairs that has a 4K screen on the wall, and so I can just put 4K images like this on a USB stick and put it in the TV, and then it slideshows through 4K images. But they're really cool because on a 4K TV looking at images, it's crazy. You can just get really close to it and it's rad. So the compositing workflow is all Photoshop and After Effects based. So you have all your passes from V-Ray, typical passes, color ID or material ID pass, just so I can isolate certain things in Photoshop if I need to, Z-Depth pass for fog and depth of field. Import those into Photoshop. Composite them the way they're supposed to be composited so that what I end up with is an image. Here's different masks to select elements. But the idea is that I end up with the image as it looks in V-Ray, but in Photoshop with all of the passes, so I can then just start making my adjustments. So what I'm seeing here is this is what the image looked like out of V-Ray, but this is the final image. And so something that really for personal work, and especially when you're doing stills, but really ultimately everything tends to get composited. Like 100% of things in visual effects are composited, and most of that work is color graded and goes through DI to tweak. So I know this process of doing this has become much more prevalent lately online, so a lot more people are talking about it, so you're probably all very aware of it. But it's just something that really only try and make your get your image like 80% of the way there with V-Ray or your rendering engine, because it'll be so much easier once you get into Nuke or Photoshop to make all those final little tweaks. So here is what it looks like from V-Ray, which is kind of not too exciting, but then with a few tweaks in Photoshop with levels adjustments and curves and so forth, I was able to make it more the way I wanted it to look. So you can see I've got a whole bunch of layers just adding in different elements, but if you go through it to see what I did in Photoshop. Diffuse, levels adjustment on the background, darkening the foreground, doing a texture overlay on the cliff on the left because I didn't like the texture. That's what I overlaid. Warming it, levels adjustment, darkening the cliff on the right, adjusting HSV, levels adjustment on the midground, all subtle, subjective things, but they go really fast because you're doing it in Maya. If I wanted to go and do it in V-Ray, I'd be like, I want that rock to be a little darker. Oh, I'm going to go to the texture in Photoshop and make the texture darker and save that to disk and then go to my material in V-Ray and reload that texture in and re-render because I wanted that dark rock to be a little darker. For stills, it's so much easier to cheat. Grabbing an image of clouds from a photograph that I took of clouds. I have a lot of cloud photos. Levels adjustment, adding some smoke that's added for the campfire. Flatten, convert to 16-bit, export to After Effects for Magic Bullet. Magic Bullet, I mentioned earlier, is a color grading plugin for After Effects, but it only works in 16-bit, not 32. So go into After Effects, load my image in. This is what Magic Bullet looks like. It's basically Instagram filters. But it has tons of them, and they're super easy to adjust because each one, you can see all the nodes that were used to create it and drag more nodes in, and so it's a non-destructive color grading tool, but it's really, really awesome. So this huge library that it has of looks, right? You can also download more online, are great starting points to then make adjustments to your images. So there's two different looks, another look. So I grab one that I like, make some adjustments, export it, back in Photoshop for final adjustments. Here I just added a texture on the background right there. Made it a little bit brighter in the right there. Super subtle things. Decided I wanted the rock on the left to be brighter. Adding some texture overlays on the ground. Bushes and fog. Added another bush right over there. Bird. Signature. And then an image. And so that's pretty much the process of what went through for this. And so, again, I had an asset, block out simple shapes, detail them in ZBrush, use a texture library to block the textures out so that ultimately the process of making natural environments goes very, very quickly. And so the photogrammetry part of this was about making more assets to my library. My library was missing something. Really cool logs, really cool tree trunks, really cool rocks. Learned photogrammetry, learned Photoscan, spent like 6 weeks just building a library. Now I have that library that I can use for years to come. And so it's super, super cool process to do. ultimately, once you learn photogrammetry and Photoscan and how to use the camera, the process, like, to me, is kind of like UVs now. Like, I used to hate UVs, now I don't hate UVing, and now UVing is kind of like this Zen thing where you can just put music on and just UV. So, like, adding things to my library is that way sometimes. I don't feel like coming up with an image, maybe I'm just like, I'm just going to add to my library today. It's a Sunday, and I'm going to make some rocks, you know. And it's time well spent, because you might use that later. And so here, just showing the difference between, again, the V-Ray render and the final render. And that's what we've gone through. So Photoscan, ZBrush, Maya, ZBrush, and World Machine, materials, compositing, and grading. So a lot of different steps. These are the tools. So camera, tripod, Lazy Susan, Amazon, Paul C. Buff, Einstein strobes. You have to order that stuff from Paul C. Buff. Pocket Wizards are BH Photo. Westcott softboxes, BH Photo, Seamless Backdrop, Castex, which is right there. C-Stands, BH Photo, or Sammy's. And then these are the tools. So Lightroom to organize the photos, Photoscan to do your processing, ZBrush to clean up and retopo and fill holes, UV layout to UV, XNormal to get your normal maps, XNView to get the edge bleed on the UV shells, Maya as the main hub, V-Ray for rendering these days, Photoshop and After Effects for compositing, even though I should use Nuke, and Magic Bullet, because it's pretty easy to use. That's it. Sure. Okay. Thank you. So I guess, thanks. So I guess, do we have time for questions?
Questions, yeah, we have about 15 minutes, if that's okay.
Sure, okay.
That was amazing, by the way, thank you.
Thank you.
So much detail. Okay, first question.
The list of tools, some of these I haven't heard of before. Are they, do they have like training, free versions to learn on or anything? Or?
As far as these, well, Lightroom, you know, you can get as part of the Adobe Creative Suite and get a subscription for that. Photoscan is kind of pricey. And so I'm not sure if they have a student version. That is the one thing about Photoscan that I guess would be a negative, is that it's, you know, I forget the precise price, but it's like $1,000 or something like that. But ultimately, if you think of the, if you're a studio and you're thinking of how much time and artist time you're saving by building these libraries, then it pays for itself pretty fast. UV layout's like $100. Maya's Maya, V-Ray's V-Ray. So Magic Bullet is not that expensive. It's like a couple $100. Yeah.
What about the texturing library? Some of those, are those?
CG Textures is like a monthly subscription. I forget what it is. I've had a subscription to that for so long. It's like $10 a month, maybe. Megascans, they keep saying it's about to come out. They've been saying that for 2 years. I'm not sure what the pricing will be for Megascans. It's really cool, though. I assume it'll be something affordable, I hope, like meaning a monthly subscription. I don't know.
Excellent. Thanks.
Okay.
Next question. I'll go to this one first.
I was going to ask, have you ever heard of anybody using medium format cameras with Photoscan?
I have not. Okay. But the, you know, the 5DS ultimately has brought, you know, medium format
comparable
to the prosumer level. So like before the 5DS, you had like the phase one, right?
Right.
So
like
you wanted a medium format digital back 50 megapixel camera, you had to spend $50,000 for a phase one. Uh-huh. 5DS came out, now we have 50 megapixel, which is really high, so like I don't know if even going beyond that with Photoscan would
be
work.
Useful.
You know, you have to try it. So, because medium back digital cameras are now probably like 150 megapixels, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so yeah, but I think ultimately the 5DS, if you wanted really high res models, can't imagine needing more than that.
Fair enough.
Cool.
How much detail do you do on the geometry and assets and textures behind the camera?
Oh, like none. Yeah, and because the thing is, you're just thinking about how it's going to affect the reflectivity, right? And so since things are glossy, like if things were chrome, then it would be a different issue. But things are, since things are glossy and they're rocky and the glossiness is like 0.2 to 0.4 on a lot of things, then it's getting a blurry reflection, so it's behind. So what I do is I put the geometry behind, but it's not detailed at all. It's just sculpt geometry, simple shapes. But I will put a texture or a shader on it that's the color that I want. So I want like warm light being reflected into the scene as if there's like some warm sandstone behind the camera. Then I'll think about the color of the texture that's on the thing behind the camera. But I wouldn't worry about it being like ZBrushed or anything. Cool.
Next question. Oh, okay.
How does the process change when you're doing it for humans and animation?
For humans it's completely different because everything I'm doing is a static object that doesn't move, right? And therefore, Photoscan, where you're walking around an object, works perfectly fine. The moment you have a person that is breathing and trying to sit still, but really not. Like anybody in here who's done figure drawing know that no matter how much models try and sit still, like 20 minutes later, you're just like, dude, that's not the same pose you were in, right? So the problem is basically that things that move, then Photoscan will not be able to solve at all. So if you go online and look at companies like Infinite Realities, I believe is one that's in the UK, where they're using Photoscan to do scans of people, they have a rig that has like 100 cameras. So like imagine 100 5Ds in a big sphere all pointing to the center where you hit a button and they all take a picture at the same time, right? That's how they're doing it. So it's the exact same process that we're doing, like exactly the same, but they spent $200,000 on cameras. Yeah, and so, but that's what's necessary because with that solution, with all of these cameras taking the picture at once, you click, you get all 109 of the photos you need. They're all taken at the same instant, so you can get scans of people. So if you go on the website for Infinite Realities, and I think it's 1024 another one that's doing that?
Yeah, 1024.
They're crazy. Yeah. Like, they're unbelievable looking, the scans of people, but they're photogrammetry. It's exactly what we just did, but they had to invest in this large array of digital cameras to shoot all the pictures of all the rows at once. So if you row from above, your row from here, your row from below, but it's all shot with the click of a button. Yeah.
Sorry, so how do you get it to deform for animation?
What do you mean? To deform for animation?
Yes.
For one of those characters?
Yes.
Well, that gets into regular like rigging, like bringing that character into Maya, character rigging it so that an animator could animate it.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's just Ninja Theory are using that technology on Hellblade, mm-hmm. and I believe if I understood them correctly, they were scanning individual facial expressions for wrinkles.
Right. That's something I'm not super familiar. I know what you're talking about because I've seen that online too, but how that's done, I don't know.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Have any more questions on the floor? We have a couple online, if that's okay.
Okay.
On Twitter, Tony is asking, what do you recommend for photogrammetry of items like juice bottles or glass or drinks?
Get some like 50% gray primer paint and spray paint them.
Ah.
Yeah. Awesome. Photoscan's not going to like transparent objects. It's not going to understand it. Mm-hmm. So that's what I've seen people do. As you just, you know, obviously it's got to be a thing you're allowed to do that to. But yeah, that would be the best solution is just to paint them. Yeah.
And Voyager FX is asking, do you see VR production using photogrammetry for scenes involving natural environments? For example, a world exploration VR experience.
Oh yeah, I think it already is. And so like, I mean, I've already been in a couple sort of VR things, you know, with Oculus and the Vive. Like there was one, we got one here and it's Brad and I was playing with it earlier today and looking at the assets that were on the ground in that underwater demo with like the bioluminescent stuff. Maybe you guys have seen that demo. Just looking at the rocks on the ground in there, it's just like, that's photoscanned. Like it's so perfect looking. So yeah, definitely. And then like X-Res, which is a rad company that belongs to Eric Hansen and Greg Downing, they've been using photogrammetry for a long time and like using drones. So like they'll, you know, have GoPro or bigger cameras on a drone and be able to fly around an area. So like I know they did like a Bjork music video in like a fjord in Iceland and they have the drone with the camera and it's flying it around this fjord and then they're taking those photos into Photoscan and building that set. You know, so obviously the application of that for VR is, yeah, if you want to just make an experience of walking through an area, then you could photo scan it. Yeah, it'd be cool.
Awesome. And then we'll take one last question on Twitter, unless anyone else. Oh, there's one over here. Let me do the Twitter. I'll do the quick one on Twitter, and I'll come over to you. So Joseph is asking, is PhotoScan reliant on CPU, RAM, or GPU when building your point cloud and polygon mesh?
Both. CPU and GPU. So if I remember correctly, you go in and you can enable the GPU optimization part in PhotoScan.
Where is the next question? Can you? Okay.
Hi. Have you ever thought about using tinfoil to get a more custom feel? Because, like you said, the scale doesn't matter, right? For the rocks and making it look like it's a large mm-hmm. area. So right. A thought came to my mind, like you could use tinfoil to adjust it the way you want it and maybe
paint
it. Oh, of course.
Yeah, yeah, totally. I mean, something that I haven't done much of yet, but it's something that I want to do, is photogrammetry is basically gives us the opportunity to get back to something like clay again. So, for example, something that I thought would be cool, I haven't tried yet, but it is something that I think could work, is I've bought the clay, I just haven't tried it yet, is just like sit on a table with a whole bunch of clay, and then I can just sit and sculpt the layout for a scene and just like sit and figure out this is the canyon, and with your hands, with clay, real fast, and block things out and grab rocks from outside and pebbles and like lay out a goddamn little set on my table, and then picture, photo scan, and now I have the block out for my set done that way. That seems pretty cool. There's no reason why you wouldn't be able to do that. So like the fact that you could use soft clay and block out environments and areas and compositions and photo scan it real quick as a way to block out a scene is something I'm super curious about, if like that could be an effective way to start doing scene layout. Could be cool. So something like tinfoil or whatever, yeah, it's like using real world objects and combining them together and using that as a way to create alphas all through scanning and knowing that you're going to photo scan it later. Sure.
Thank you.
Excellent. So I think that's it. Oh, one last question. It's always on the opposite side of the room.
How do we access this video?
Google Gnomon Livestream, and you'll get to our Livestream page, and you'll see it in there.
Okay. Do you think that photos can, with that, an easier time to mask out the object if you have a green screen or something behind instead of a...
But then you're going to get all this green spill on, or it's green light that you then have to further process your photos to remove the green spill. And I don't think that would make it any easier, because what I showed is really easy. You just have the photo of the background without the object, and it made pretty much a perfect mask. You know, so I think... there's no reason why. I have seen some images online where people clearly were using a green screen instead of the white background, but to me, I just preferred the idea of my object being enveloped in white for more even lighting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. Awesome. Okay, I'm calling it.
Okay.
That was amazing.
All right,
huge round
you.
Of applause.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Alex. If anyone does want to check out the live stream, it's livestream.com/Gnomon. So thanks, everyone, for joining us. If you want to rewatch, head to the live stream channel. You can also follow us on live stream, and you'll get a notification the next time we announce an event and also when we start streaming. We also have lots more events coming up, too. So gnomon.edu/events. We do always keep our mailing list and social media followers up to date on events. So if you want to sign up to the newsletter, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, please do so. The next event is Saturday, June 11th, which is a movie poster design workshop with the amazing Thomas Opaczynski. He's working at Netflix right now, and he has a bunch of cool stuff to show. And that one won't be live streamed. So if you're in LA, I do recommend coming. And following that, we'll have Luma Pictures here on Thursday, June 16th from 7:30 p.m. We'll be announcing the lineup for that soon, but it's going to be great. a Luma Pictures event. They're a studio based in Santa Monica. So if anyone has a chance to stick around, we have the gallery show over on the north side of the campus, which is episode 7, The Art of James Klein and Ian McCaig. So do check that out. Or if anyone wants to take a tour of the campus, just let myself or Ray over here know, and we can show you around. Yeah, thank you so much, everyone. Thanks, Alex. Have a good night.